We are going to do a show. All right. The reason there's a big wide camera angle is because hopefully Justin Robert Young will be sitting there shortly, but he is really tired and still, I think, asleep. So I'm not bugging him because the travel tales he has told me makes me wonder how he's alive. So he may, I'm not going to make him get up because that would be A, rude, and B, also rude. Continually rude. Which is what I would be if I didn't add Brian to the call. So let's do that. Let's do that. Give us the chocolate cake. Boo-doo-doo. Boo-doo-boo-doo-boo-doo.
Scott Johnson.
Boo-doo-boo-boo-boo-boo-boo.
Hello.
Brian Ibbott.
Ah, look at your big fat iMac. It's all fat.
It's fat. No, actually, this is just fat. This is just a display.
Oh, that's
but also looks fat compared to the new iMac.
Yeah, so that means if it's just a display, it could be even thinner if they laminate it right to the glass.
You mean right? So there's only a 5 millimeters between that and the aluminium? Is that what
we
you're saying?
We got rid of the 2 millimeters of air between, yeah.
Yeah. So they, that's funny you say that because I was pissed at Phil Schiller, who I like. He's such a nerd. I think that guy's great. Gets on stage and just eats it up. Well, he gets up there and it's bad enough, he says. You know, they've got this hot new iMac that's so thin and amazing and blah, 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 blah. But it makes it worse by then saying, now let's take a look at the last model or the last revision. Pulls it up. And then he goes, doesn't the new whatever make everything look old and stupid? I'm like, dude, I just bought it 6 months ago. What are you doing to me here?
Exactly.
Not even 6 months. It's been like 3. I didn't know.
And that could easily, you know, the iPad could fall into that same thing. Oh, yeah, bought that 6 months ago. Oh, yeah. Doesn't look like old technology things.
A lot of people are mad about that, but honestly, all you're getting, the differences are the cable style. So it's the lightning cable and the faster chip. That's it.
Yeah.
So it's not that big a deal.
No, and it's funny. I got an email from Wayne from the UK this morning, or probably overnight. He forwarded an email that he sent to Apple saying, what's the deal? It's like, you just got to remind yourself, were you happy with your iPad 2 days ago? Mm-hmm. Then you should still be happy with your iPad.
Yeah, but
your iPad hasn't changed.
It's the constant Apple thing that you just, you try to get in when you get in, and if you get lucky, you got a good couple of years where you're cutting edge.
Sure.
And if you don't, then you're like the old and stupid.
Yeah, no, it's true.
But the iPad thing, oddly enough, like that's got Eileen in a rage.
What, really?
Yeah, and I don't even care about it. I think she's just got Android blood in her, so it pisses her off. But but that didn't bother me at all. And none of it bothered me. All of it looked awesome. I'm just irritated that I got my iMac right before the Switch. But what are you going to do? I needed it. I had to have it.
Mm-hmm.
I had work to do. Okay, people?
Yeah. Dude, I've got an iMac, and I'm super happy with it. I don't care if it's not Retina display. I don't care if it's nothing. I guess the iMacs aren't.
Well, they're technically Retina in the sense that they support similar resolutions, but
that's right. Yeah,
they're not Retina in the sense that they use an actual like the Retina technology, and therefore the pixel density isn't like Retina. That's hard to explain, but
yeah,
it kind of it sort of works out the same in a weird way. Mm-hmm. So,
I'd like to see them slowly increase the size of the iPhone 5.
Yeah.
And decrease the size of the iPad and until they become exactly the same size and see how long it takes somebody to notice.
I love how we should say I have this in the show thing. We're going to talk about this in the show.
All right.
It's one of our news stories. And here we are yapping about it already. So we're going to hold that. So stay tuned, everyone.
Save it for the show.
Saving it for the show.
The podcasting t-shirt that we keep promising to make.
Mm-hmm. Now, Justin's upstairs asleep still.
Is he really? Yeah. He couldn't be bothered to get up for this?
Well, I could. See, that's the question. I've wrestled with it all morning. He told me tales of travel that have made me wonder how he's literally existing in our world. And I thought, wow, that's crazy. And we went to bed probably about 11 last night. We did a little recording, just live stream stuff last night.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked pretty beat. And so I said, well, let's hit the hay and, you know, you want to do this in the morning? He says, oh, yeah, yeah. And I said, okay, cool. But part of me said, he's exhausted.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not going to wake him. This is the first time he's had a comfortable bed in probably 3 weeks.
does he have some way, like, did he have a way of waking himself up if he wanted to get up for this?
That room's full of electronics, an iPhone 5, a computer, an iPad. Like, he's got all the alarm needs necessary. Okay.
So that's what I'm saying. I mean, like, if he, you know...
I was not his alarm calls, put it that way.
Okay. Yeah. I was going to say, if he's relying on you to wake him up, then... No,
he said... Well, he said yesterday, he says, you know what I'm going to... He goes, I'm going to wake up around... He goes, around 6:30 or 7. Is that cool? I said, yeah, that's great. Mm-hmm. So that, you know, seemed well in hand. So, yeah, there was no intention. But I am I'm still slightly torn. I'm like, well, should I go shake him? I still want to... I don't want to wake... I feel bad.
Cleo, she says, Tadpole suggests glass of cold water and a webcam. I actually think bucket of warm water and a webcam is a much better option. Yeah,
start with his hand in it, see how that works out. But he's fine. We had jambalaya last night, watched Walking Dead. Yeah. I don't know what else you could ask for in life.
Nice. Had he seen, like, did you guys watch it?
We caught up. Both of us had missed the second episode, cool. So we both caught up last night. Cool. So we're all caught up now. I think that show's really good this season so far.
Oh, yeah.
They've gotten back to what I like, which is killing a lot of zombies and doing it in horrific ways and taking Chico the Man out early with the axe.
I know. He was a little
wow. That was scary, quick.
Scary dude. Yeah.
Quick, too.
I just like that it totally was, and it was unexpected. I mean, it's...
I think they're getting past this whole, let's drag out a single story point for 12 episodes. Right. I think they're getting to the point where they're like, you know what? Let's have a whole bunch of crap go down in one and just keep doing that.
Yeah.
And that's fine.
And we are starting to see Rick turn the corner, you know?
Uh-huh. It's a good old turn the corner Rick is what we got there. he was great in this episode, too. He used to bug me. I used to find him kind of very one-note.
Yes.
His performance. Right. And I'm now starting to see a lot of nuance. And there's a lot going on in his face. Mm-hmm. Justin said it well yesterday. He says he's almost better when he's not talking sometimes. Not because he can't talk, but because... You're seeing a lot of crap going on in his head just by looking at him. Ironic name, I will not fart on his face. That is not how I wake him up. I gave that up a long time ago. Anyway, I call him on Skype. I mean, you know what I could do? I could text him. And I'll just I'll say,
I feel like we got to have him on the show. He's
what
like
I'll
in
say.
The house.
Yeah, it would be dumb if he didn't.
Right.
But
exactly. Give him, you know, basically say, dude, no, you're tired. If you want to sleep, sleep. Or just, you know, respond. Respond with a bunch of Z's, and I know you just want to stay in bed and sleep.
Please don't.
Way, hey, we need Mitt Romney. Way, hey, we need Mitt Romney.
I haven't heard Way, that yet. Hey.
Oh my god! It sounds just like that.
I didn't
that.
See it in his
feed. It's in August. Apparently, he did in August.
Oh, okay.
Give you a link.
Yeah, send me a link, will you? I just want to hear it.
Early in November.
You don't. You're doing it pretty good.
It's. I'm actually feeling like it's dead on. Yeah. There it is. Yeah, and the most recent commenter on early in November is Tadpooler Dale Campbell.
Oh, fantastic.
Okay, there's a link in the... Oh, I put in the Tadpool.
Here it is. Oh, no, this is a...
I grew up in a socialist country.
Damn you.
And I have seen what that does to...
Damn you.
You know what's funny? That comes up all the time for you. I have yet to have it come up on any videos I've watched on YouTube.
Well, here, I just ran another one. Oh, jeez. Third Eagle is loud.
Yeah, that's right there.
It's got sound issues. Yeah, it must be. I don't know what that is. Maybe I know that they can localize stuff, you know.
I think they must have because I have not gotten that one.
Why do they? If that thing's, I don't even know what it is. I've never clicked through because I don't know what that super PAC is actually advertising. I assume it's pro Romney. I can only assume.
Salt Lake City for Romney.
Yeah.
This ad paid for by Salt Lake City for Romney.
Yeah, it could be. And all I know is their little ad thing covers it up so I can't see who it's paid for by. So for all I know, it's whatever. But if they're doing that here in this market and they're pushing it that hard, they're making a mistake because they're all voting for Romney here anyway. It's a done deal. You don't have to worry. Save your money. Spend that in Portland or something. I don't know why Portland came in my head. Let's just hear this here. Eurovision Song Competition.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Put your hands up. Put your hands up. Boy, his font choices.
All right. This is not common sense.
Way, hey, we need Mitt Romney. Way, hey, we need Mitt Romney. Way, hey, we need Mitt Romney. Early in November.
Early?
Early.
You know, I want to kick you in your shriveled up old raisin man nuts. I really do. Well, anyway.
Is there any chance in the world he's not touching little boys right now?
I don't know, but that is a bold statement.
I'm kidding.
About the lifestyle of Third Eagle.
I'm kidding.
William, can you tell me what it means when the Holy Spirit will testify? I've had a hard time. I've had many of these supernatural encounters on various churches, prayer groups, and the spiritual movies. Movies. Something to that effect. Oh, look who it is, everybody. It's Justin Robert Young. Yeah, go sit in your comfy chair and take your thing on. Look, I got new headphones. How you doing, dude? Here, let me turn this on. Sorry. Got to turn on his mic. I knew.
Justin?
Oh, no.
Is this coming through yet? Why am I not hearing you yet? Okay, now try.
Check.
There it is. Can you hear him?
2, 4, 6, 8
Sounds, you know, a little rough, but he sounds fine.
Yeah. Oh, I'll tell you what, man. I certainly didn't just wake up.
Well, that's why we got this wide-angle camera. Everybody can see us. Actually, see how that looks. Yeah, I think see you even more than me. Check that out. Look at you over there in the corner. Looking all bright and bushy-tailed.
Is that coffee you have there?
Yeah, it's in a Wonder Woman mug.
Exactly.
Nice.
I got coffee in a Wonder Woman mug, which is how I roll.
Yeah, it's how he does business.
That's like it's got to be the one time a year that Kim makes coffee.
Yeah, pretty much.
You guys don't drink it. Yeah.
Pretty much. Kim loves her frozen mocha hoo-ha whatcha-ma-hoochie-hoochie she gets at the whatchamacallit, but down to the Piggly Wiggly. I don't know what I'm saying, but it's real good stuff. So we were just talking about this guy here.
What will he do with Barack Obama? What will he do with Barack Obama?
I freaking can't handle it.
Okay, well, who is that guy?
This is the Third Eagle of the Apocalypse guy. We talk about him on the show all the time, but he's like a freak. Like he claims he's a co-prophet of the end times, and so he's got all these
co-prophet.
Yeah,
co-prophet.
Exactly.
So that's exactly to take on that role himself. Right. He actually has to have a
nice. Like, I'm the Third Eagle of the Apocalypse, co-prophet of all of our doom. Who's the other prophet? I don't know.
Pedro. Some other guy.
He's a guy I met at the Piggly Wiggly while Kim was getting coffee.
Yeah, so he's
getting a mocha what's a hoochie
down at the what's the faces. But he's the guy that says things like
Vladimir Putin
and what was the other one,
the homosexual movement,
and
giving him oral,
that guy, that's the guy. You're missing out if you haven't seen his stuff. It's
no
horrendous.
I get a good look at his visage.
Well, back in the day he did a Colbert did a big thing with it, because he did this whole thing about Denver International Airport having everything look like penises.
Looking like a big phallus.
Like
yeah.
Phalluses everywhere. So he got kind of famous for that.
It's like where's dildo?
Yeah.
Going through the airport
and
saying,
the
oh, that looks like one right there.
Everywhere.
A little red and white striped hide on it.
Yeah. That's exactly right. So let's see. I'm just testing some volume/. Let's see. Is that better? Is that more central? Blah, blah, blah. Central. Blah, blah, blah. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I think we can do a show now if you guys want.
Hell yeah.
Do you have any food handy? Should we do I think Daryl was saying that he always brings, like, he's got all the food with him. So maybe
all
we do Corinne food or something?
Yeah. Where is Corinne food? Is it? Hang on. Let me go over there and look.
Oh, did you get Corinne food?
Dude, I did not want to bug you. You seem so tired.
No, I have a 6:30 alarm that always goes off, and then I set a 7 alarm.
Yeah.
So I intentionally slept through the 6:30 one, And then I don't know what happened to the 7 o'clock one.
If he gets, you know, Jerry, if you get too tired, you can sleep. You can sleep during the show, like I do.
I don't have all I have in my possession. I don't know where Corinne's stuff went. I think Kim put it somewhere funny. So what? Let's do. Why don't we finally do these candy corn Oreos? It's
probably next to the What's a Hoochie.
We have candy corn Oreos.
Did you not get these?
Oh, I didn't get candy corn Oreos.
Snap, son.
Oh, look at that, dude.
Look who's getting flapjacks, eggs, and bacon.
Hey, honey, do you know where Corinne's food is that she sent? Can you bring... Okay, never mind. Kim's going to bring the Corinne food. If you didn't get the Oreos, I feel bad about that. Who sent this? Someone sent it via... Who's Mary Heidenberg? I can't believe you didn't get those.
I can't believe it either. Mary Heidenberg.
Jeez.
Yeah, up your nose with a rubber hose.
Yeah, more like Heisenberg.
Yeah, sit on it, Potsy.
Yeah.
All right, let me go get Corinne food. All right,
get Corinne food. We'll get this show
I'm going to get a slab of bacon in my mouth.
Yeah, that's the good stuff, too. It's turkey, so you won't die from it. But, I mean, you know, it's arguably it isn't the best, isn't the good stuff, but I think it's the good stuff.
I think it's great.
Yeah, I like it. Yeah, I forgot. Kim made breakfast. Which I have already partaken in. All right, let's see.
What will he do with Barack Obama? Early in November.
Oh, he's such a goof.
Way, hey, we need Third Eagle. Way, hey, we need Third Eagle.
All right, so I've got... What do you want to take out of this?
Let's see.
There's old-fashioned hard candy, which is supposed to be really good. Then there's
the Whorehound?
Not like that movie, hopefully.
Yeah, is it Whorehound? Yeah, let's do the Whorehound.
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay.
Old Pioneer candy.
Yeehaw! We'll save that for Daryl. 3rd Eagle, goodbye.
Yeah, that way we get to do 4 people testing food today.
3rd Eagle of the Apocalypse. I hope he sings more. That's my favorite thing that guy does. Oh, you know what I haven't done? Oh, crap. I never told people the show was live. Hold on. Let me just do this real quick. TMS is live. I usually do my little routine, but I haven't done it. Tweet on that Twitter. Let's just go ahead and retweet that while we're at it. Oh, no. Didn't mean to open it.
What will he do with the co-prophet of the end times? What will he do with the co-prophet of the end times?
You know, you're uncanny.
You know who he sounds like when you do it, and maybe it's your impression of him, is...
Wildman Fisher?
No, it's like Sharky. You know, like, no respect at all.
You mean the Saturday morning cartoon?
Yes, Sharky? Exactly. Yeah,
my God.
The ripoff of Rodney Dangerfield.
Right.
Let's see. Morning stream on Facebookery. Okay, let's do it. That's probably why we have less people in there. I didn't remind everyone. Sorry, chat room. Although this is a decent crowd. We're all right. Okay, let's do it.
Okay.
I think we're ready. Oh, music. Ah, crap.
Oh, jeez.
I feel like I'm a little off with all my timing here because I don't...
Just before you ask, silence at the end, summer at the beginning.
Okay, today's Wednesday. Summer at the end or beginning?
Summer in the middle.
Okay.
Silence at the end.
Okay, hold on. Okay, and... Okay, let's see how they start. Okay.
There you go.
I got it. I think I'm okay.
Okay.
All righty. Let me just save the the show.
Thorin, that's awesome.
What happened?
He's put a link in the tadpole. You got to scroll up a little bit. It's already scrolled past the horizon.
Let's take a look here. The Walking Third Eagle of the Apocalypse. Fantastic. That's a Dale. That's a little bit Dale outfit there.
It is. Yeah.
Okay. Well. I think we're ready. Justin, you feeling it? You good?
Oh, Christ. I'm into it.
let's see how we manage.
Oh, boy.
All right. Here we go.
You know there are no F-bombs on TMS,
by the way. Clean tag, everybody.
Whoa! Number one, I'm not the one who curses during my segment. Don't get up in my grill.
That's a good point. We got to watch that Tom Merritt today. Remind him.
Yeah. Oh God.
We
yes.
have standards Jeez. Here.
Yeah. I don't know that new crowd he's running with.
I know. I know.
Him and the Lindsay Lohans of the world. Now that he's gone, Hollywood.
That's right. All right, here we go. I'm going to count it down, read off my thing, play the intro, and off we go. It begins in three. Ooh, we're running late. 2, 1. If you melt it, they will come.
Listen to Remco's baby laugh a lot. You're listening to Baby Laugh-A-Lot. She's the funniest doll you've ever seen. Just push the button and she starts to giggle. Get Baby Laugh-A-Lot by Remco.
How does he get his unbelievable power?
On a drug, and it's called the morning stream.
Well, hello everybody, and welcome back to the morning stream. That song tells you all you need to know. It's a lazy Sunday walk through the annals of radio good times.
From the 1970s, yes.
Hey everyone, it's Scott Johnson here. That's Brian Ibbott. Welcome
hello.
Back to TMS. Hello, Brian. How's it going, man?
Thank you. It's good. I'm doing well. Thanks. How are you?
Good. I
forgot
I'm fine.
What your question was
I'm doing okay. Thanks. We're all fine here. A boring conversation anyway. Boom, boom. Walk down the hall in my suit made of white armor. Hey, it's Wednesday, October 24th, 2012, and it's about 8:14 a.m. Mountain Time Zone, the only time zone that matters, which is a little later than we usually start. But I am so happy to announce the following information. All right?
All right.
We play this as a result, as a thing here.
That's no way to treat a guest.
In the studio today, sitting to my left, we have the one, the only, Mr. Justin Robert Young.
Yay!
Live. Live.
I don't know. Let's see if we can call him on Skype. He may be sleeping.
I don't know how you... after spending a little bit of time with you, I was telling Ibbott this at the top of the show, I don't know how you're alive with your schedule.
Yeah.
It's got to be some sort of weird youthful thing or some kind of...
pact with the devil.
A hex, yeah.
Hex.
Something in the supernatural realm.
Man, that'd be great if I stepped on a witch's toe and she's like, I ban you to do a lot of traveling. Like, that doesn't seem too bad. Yes.
Sleep on couches.
Very little sleep.
Yes. Watch bad TV in hotel rooms.
It's like, man... The hex business isn't what it used to be.
No, it isn't. But it's good to have you here, dude. He's here in town doing a thing in Salt Lake. And
super thrilled. Yeah, doing the Go Game here in old Salt Lake City.
Yeah.
And it brings me to the morning stream.
Now, Brian, what do you think Justin's first impression of Salt Lake would be? Just take a guess. Do you think he liked it? Do you think he hated it? Do you think he's weirded out? What do you think?
What's not to like about Salt Lake City? It is so friendly. You know, you go out and I'm not exaggerating when I say that just about everybody that you interact with in stores, in restaurants, whatever, is they're all just super friendly and happy. It's like you're looking for the man pulling the wires. Like there's Kool-Aid behind the counter that
Well, see that and so that's the question, I guess. Does that niceness come off as
It does not come off as
creepy
disingenuous.
Children of the corn.
Yeah, children of the corn kind of thing.
No.
Right, all...
Outlander! No, I mean, this was... I've never been to Salt Lake City except to maybe fly through the airport. Mm-hmm. And it's awesome. Mm-hmm. Like, I kind of like... There's an earnestness to Salt Lake City that I don't know is really kind of like a part of the city makeup in other towns that I've been to. Even like, you know, like... There's places in like the Deep South or like, you know, like through Alabama and everything that kind of have their own sort of feel to it. But
sure.
I don't know, like Salt Lake City in general just kind of feels like it's like, hey, I'm gonna go pick up your dry cleaning, and I'm like, I don't even have dry cleaning, but sure.
You're right. Earnestness is a good way to put it. There's an industrious sort of sense of like people know where they're going and what they got to do. It's just like this. It's hard to explain.
You want to know what? Like, the political billboards have been very, very exciting because they're everywhere. There's a great sense of civic duty, I think.
Big time, yeah.
In Utah.
It's pounded into us from childhood.
But also, there's no, like, mean ones.
No.
It's all like the billboards are like, a lot of people like this guy. It's like, more people across the aisle like this guy than the other guy. I mean, he's fine. I've met him. He's a nice guy. Yeah. But he's not as well liked.
Yeah. As general city cultures go, it's not a very confrontational, angry city.
No.
And that's how it's always been. It's a very Republican city, so you don't get a lot of competition from the other side.
Yeah.
But that's okay. I mean, you do have people run. They just lose.
But it's like in The Wire, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like the Democratic primary is effectively the election.
That's right. That's exactly right. And so I make no bones about it on this show that I'm very fond of my hometown.
Yes.
So, but I'm always interested when people come in here. Usually their first impression is usually, oh my gosh, the mountains are like right here and holy crap, they're huge. And
they are gigantic.
It's amazing.
That's something that always startles me as a man from Florida. Yeah. Anytime that the land rises up to meet you, I'm frightened and confused and just start involuntarily crying.
Yeah. And in this place, I mean, the valley anyway, you're walled in. It's like a big, it used to be a lake. It's a prehistoric lake.
Yeah.
You know, with dinosaurs and the whatnot.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah, it's where they found a bunch of them dinosaurs in there.
And it was founded by the everybody walked the dinosaurs.
Yeah,
some people were playing. Where they built
it was not was. Yeah,
They found B. Arthur's left femur in the middle of it out there. I don't know what that's even a reference for. So, hey, welcome to the show, everybody. It's good to be back. Holy crap, Brian, we got stuff today. Jesse's going to be here all day with us. Which
sure.
Be great. Got Tom later. Got Nicole later. Let's start things off with a thing of the day. This is more of a follow-up, but an additional thing of the day sent to us by Matt from Chicago. This is another doing weird stuff in the bathroom crap while you're at work.
Holler. Oh,
like potato chips we had the day before yesterday. Yesterday was what?
Doritos in the shower.
Yeah. So today it's Hi Stalker and Shelly. I heard you guys discussing eating in the bathroom the other morning, and I thought I'd share a similar story. That says sheer.
Sheer.
Hold on.
He's a barber.
You can hear me cough even though I hit my cough switch on his microphone.
Oh, on his microphone, sure.
Fantastic.
It's quieter, though.
My coworker...
I'll just make a noise to cover it.
Yeah, just go...
I'll just act like there's a bird.
It's the cough switch. My coworker's girlfriend manages an artist studio. The studio shares a floor and restroom with a collection agency. The owner of the collection agency is a total dictator. Puts the dick in dictator, I suppose.
Yeah.
And does not allow her employees to either take breaks or to eat at their desks. So as a desperate move, they have resorted to eating their lunches in the bathroom. And in order to dispose of any evidence of their food wrappers and remnants, they put these all up and down the toilet. Oh, they end up down the toilet. This was evident the day when a toilet began to overflow and after a vigorous plunging and half-eaten Whopper floated out. Half-eaten Whopper, dude! Floated out of the turlet.
Oh, my God.
Eating in the bathroom is wrong, and in this city, Whoppers are way too expensive to be flushed. Really? In Chicago, you pay too much for a Whopper?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're way more expensive in Chicago because of the
great Whopper tax
and slime shortage.
Okay. Yeah. You would think they'd have more. They do a lot of slaughtering there.
The Tomato Act of 1963, yes.
Aren't they America's shoulders, or what's their stupid...
The city with the big shoulders?
Is that what
America's
it is?
Meat market?
I thought it was America.
Toddlin' Town. Windy City.
Windy City.
Yeah,
no. City with too many nicknames.
You know what we are here?
What's that?
The Beehive State.
A Beehive State, really?
Because we're busy as bees.
I dated a girl from Salt Lake City, and we once got into an actual fight because... What do you call denizens of this fine state?
Utahns.
Utahns.
Mm-hmm.
I said it should be Utonians. And for some reason, that like touched off an element of state pride in her, and we actually got into a fight about it.
Wow. There is a... You will... I hate to keep going back to this, but people do get very protective of this place. It's weird. I do. I find myself doing it.
Yes. I think... And you should be proud to be a Utonian.
Utonian. All Utonians.
With this story here.
Yeah.
I really think that this adds just a whole new level of office stress to these poor people.
Oh,
because, like, imagine, like, not only are you about to go eat something.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But then, like, imagine old Trucker Joe goes in there before you and just drops, like, the deuce of all deuces. And you're like, oh, God, I was going to eat this Whopper, but yeah. Now I have to wait another hour and a half. And then even then, it still kind of lingers like an old ghost, like.
Yeah. Well, here's the question. Why? How is a Whopper of the correct constitution that it will resurface? That I don't know if I even buy that. Like, I feel like I'm getting told a story here.
A Whopper, if you will.
Yeah, like if you cut a Whopper in half and shove it down a toilet, Brian, I don't see that coming up after any sort of saturation period.
Well, if it's clogging the toilet and you plunge it out and whatever's stuck is going to come back out.
Yeah, but looking like half a Whopper? You know what I mean?
I can't believe that you find that this is the issue you have with this.
No, listen, ladies and gentlemen.
We have a woman who's not letting people take lunch breaks. That's illegal. You have to, if you have employees who work for a certain period of time, like what, 3 hours or more, you're supposed to get a 15-minute break, and I think 8 hours, you're supposed to get an hour and then 2 15-minute breaks. Come on!
So your problem is the human cost of this workplace environment, and I'm worried about how a Whopper can stay together after so much time in the water.
The people who made your iPad are treated better than these people at this at this collection agency.
They're listening to this on the speakers at Foxconn, as they do.
Yeah.
And they're like,
right.
Well, it's easy
for
them.
Oh, that wrong.
It's like 4 o'clock in
we
the afternoon there.
A Whopper?
They don't care.
Hey, listen. All right. Tadpool, here you go. You've heard of the X Prize. Welcome to the W Prize. Mm. If you have a guest bathroom, go get a Whopper. Mm. Toss that bad boy on in there. Take a picture tomorrow morning before the show.
Yeah.
Send it to Scott and Brian. Yeah. And we're going to see how well a Whopper hangs out in a toilet bowl.
See, this is what they do on NSFW. A simple comment or conversation opens up a huge opportunity for some social fun.
Exactly. Right.
And I don't know why I didn't think of this.
Throwing Whoppers in a toilet.
I got to start thinking about this stuff more. So let's do it. Whopper Challenge 2012.
Here's the way it could work, right? You're eating your Whopper in the bathroom.
Yeah.
You can't finish it for whatever reason.
Yes, you do have to eat half the Whopper. That's part of the experiment.
Right, right.
But you don't throw the Whopper in the toilet just like that. You wrap it back up in the paper.
Oh.
And
so there's a little bit of air displacement, probably some prevention of saturation.
Some mummification of the food.
Well, the paper bag's going to soak right through. Maybe you throw that in a different toilet.
Let me go ahead and give you a pro tip.
All right.
Don't then, in the ensuing several hours, use the toilet for bodily functions.
Yes, please don't. Yes.
Go use another toilet. If you don't, this is an experiment for two toilet families only.
Yeah. Yeah, I would. We're going to recommend that you do the Whopper challenge. Let's see how this goes. And you know what? It reminded me of one quick thing I want to mention before we call our stump a Trek nerd friend Daryl. I think we should have more friendly competitions between Tadpoolers and chat realms. Yeah, I really do. There's a lot of crossover there, but I also think there'd be some good friendly competition we should come up with.
You said color war?
Something. Yeah. Race war. And you, since you're ambiguously ethnic, we don't know what you are yet.
You can finally the race war of 2012.
You can lead the people that go. Is he Indian? Is he Jewish? Is he Italian? Exactly. I don't know what that guy is. And then we'll do Brian. What are we? The white pasty bald people? What are we? What's our race?
Well, I'm the bald person.
We're both crackers, though.
Quite a fight.
We're both crackers.
There we go. So it's 2012 race war. Whites versus the others.
That just seems appropriate somehow. Think about that out there, you guys listening at home. If you want to come up with some cool ideas where we can have friendly competitions. I mean, I was trying to think how to work this Whopper thing into it, but I don't think you can.
I think maybe we should do, maybe it should be like a thing for, well, we'll do a couple things like now, but 2013, we last for the entire year, and we just have like, every month we have like a little thing, and then like we'll have like a big cup or something.
That just changes, virtual cup that changes hands.
Yes.
I'm all right with that. Yeah.
If we would have thought about this more, it would have been the perfect opportunity to do the smear campaigns because we've got.
Oh, right.
We could have had. Candidate and running mate here, candidate and running mate there. And
Brian's right.
And we've done we've done those, we had an election, I think. A year or so ago.
You guys did the hate campaigns?
And did the hate campaign. Mm. We have, so there's floating around now, whenever somebody Googles my name or Brian's name, there's a good chance that you're going to get, like, you know, the fact that I'm, I don't know, like a child diddler or something like that.
Child diddler.
Yeah.
I hope that never shows up in an actual anti campaign ad. hey, it's time. Let's use the word child diddler to now move on to Stump a Trek nerd.
Oh, come on, no.
Because how appropriate is that?
No.
Got to play his theme song like we usually do. So here we go. Colin Darryl. It's Stump a Trek Nerd, brought to you by
Ponytails, a story about horses. Check out the Kickstarter at bit.ly/ponytails.
Pony.
P-A-L-E-S.
Yeah, ponytails.
Man, that Kickstarter's connected. Brian tweeted that last night.
That's what I was seeing. I saw I love ponies or something, and then they retweeted it.
Yeah, I think he's got Fund My Stuff Karma initiative right now, because he just cashed in on a solid,
That's true.
You know, 20 large on his. So he's
doing all right.
Who wants? Now's the time. If you have a Kickstarter or an Indiegogo, hit up Brian.
Yeah.
Because he is ready to pay it forward, as Haley Joel Osment teaches us.
This is totally an off-topic thing, but do you know why he chose Indiegogo over Kickstarter? Did he ever say why?
Yeah.
What, was there a specific reason?
Part of it was he didn't... Kickstarter has a rule that you can't start e-businesses off it.
Yeah.
Like, it needs to be like a physical thing or a thing with an endpoint.
Like a product or a piece of something.
Yeah, or like what you guys did with Autopilot, you know, where it was like, it's like, okay, well, it ends and then you get X.
You get this thing, and it's not a business.
And he wanted the option to have it be like, all right, we'll pay for an infrastructure that I can do this in the future.
Okay.
So that's why he wound up going. He didn't even try to submit it to Kickstarter. He just went with Indiegogo.
That makes sense. And he's doing just fine. So it doesn't. And those sites are virtually the same. My prediction for 2013: Kickstarter, Indiegogo. One of the other, probably Kickstarter, buys Indiegogo. You watch. Mark my words.
I don't think they
need to. Oh, I don't think they do either. But you watch, they'll do it.
I don't know.
They're gonna merge. Hey, Daryl, you there?
I am.
Star Trek Daryl, it's time to stump you with a hard trivia question. He is the Trek nerd. He comes in here because he knows a lot about Star Trek. Daryl, do you have food with you, by the way? We just want to make sure before we get there.
I have some. I don't know if I have the right stuff.
Do you have
Whorehound?
Do you have Whorehound hard candy?
Oh, I'd remember that name. Wait.
It came in the box with the other stuff from Karen.
Yeah. Natural
herb. Is this the Utah package?
Yes.
Yes.
Well.
Oh, okay. So this one's the...
I wrestled under the name the Utah package a while ago, but that was a long time ago.
Okay, Daryl, quick warm-up question. When Riker threw his Whopper in the toilet, how long did it last?
Well, now I have questions about this. Is this with the bun on? Is it with pickles, tomatoes, mustard? All these things are going to affect it.
See, that's what I'm saying. Daryl's thinking where my brain is, so I don't feel so bad now. That's exactly what I was thinking. How intact is this burger?
Special orders don't upset us. Pickles.
Onions, cheese, and lettuce.
Special orders don't upset us. You can have it your way, and then throw it in the toilet.
Wait, that's McDonald's, right? Well, McDonald's is known.
No, have it your way is Burger King.
Is it have it your way?
Yeah. Yes.
Well, what's McDonald's?
I'm loving it as McDonald's.
Oh, I'm loving it.
Ba 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 ba.
To all beef patty, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions, and sesame seed bun.
Keeping the hot side hot and the cool side cool. I'm trying to think of all the things I did. I hate I'm loving it. You know why? Because it doesn't speak for me whatsoever. I'm not loving it. I'm hating it.
Yeah.
Okay.
I go there and I get sick.
See, this is the most aggressive I've ever seen anybody from Utah get.
I am mad.
This is how they all are in their basements.
It's when they're out in public. They get in the basements and they go, jeez, I hate McDonald's.
Well, you got to let it out somewhere. You know, we supposedly we have the highest rate. So hotels that offer adult film rental, apparently Utah hotels have the highest rate of hotel porn rental in the entire country.
Because you probably dudes going there on their lunch break.
I'm gonna eat this Whopper and I'm gonna watch
some porn. They eat on the turlet,
and then they go watch an adult film.
And then they go watch
an ambiguously a censored adult film at the Marriott.
Right.
But apparently people come here and that's what they do. Who knows? I don't know. All right, Daryl. Here's your hard trivia question. You ready for this?
Oh wait, how do we get driving down that road?
I don't even know. Oh, did we determine you have the Whorehound? Do you have that?
Boy, I don't think I do.
Oh.
Is in the Utah
spelled weird?
Spelled with a W.
It's got I do have it.
Yeah, yeah. It isn't Horror Hound or Whore Hound.
Hoo-a Hound.
I want to say on the Sopranos.
Yeah, it's a real Hoo-a Hound.
Hoo-a Hound. Right, Daryl, who's
when
your...
I see a label like this, I just have to draw a W on there.
Yeah, why not?
It so, can't stay the way it is.
No, nah, that's a rebel right there.
It is. He's always, and he's without a cause. Daryl, here's your cause for today. Here's your hard trivia question.
Who are you playing for?
Yeah, who are you playing for? In the original series episode, And the Children Shall Lead.
Oh, no.
Oh, I was waiting for your reaction. Kirk, Spock, and McCoy beam down to the planet Triacus.
Yeah.
After receiving a distress call, they find a large group of dead bodies. One man is alive, but soon dies. McCoy, of course, confirms this. They find a dead woman with something in her mouth. They investigate it and find it was a poisonous chemical compound. What does McCoy say this poison is? Is it cyalodin, polyatrix? How would you say that, Brian?
Sorry, I'm drawing a W on my package.
Polysaccharide.
Polysaccharide.
Okay, polysaccharide. Thank you. Chloride.
Oh, that sounds good.
And then D, this is why I've got out of med school. D is acetylcyclone.
Acetylchlorine.
Acetylchlorine. This is why you should have been a doctor, Brian.
Or a spaceman.
My dad wanted me to be.
I know you had all these doctors in your family, and you chose not to.
And I decided I'll be a podcaster.
Yeah. I don't want to cut people open and touch their wieners.
Ew.
So there's your question, Daryl. But before we get to it, I would like to propose that we dabble in this. But I'm gonna play this.
Are you hungry?
Watch a foodie.
Let's open up the whorehound, and Justin, you gotta
that
try
smells
one of
like
these.
This smells like a dentist's office in this bag.
Really?
Nice.
Really? Weird.
Well, as Scott opens up the whorehound, let me just say this, and I used to listen to the Stump a Trek Nerd segment a lot more when it was on the day that I was on the morning stream.
It does smell like a dentist. Go ahead. Keep going.
But I don't know if I have ever heard Daryl, and you have a good success rate, but, like, I don't think I've ever heard you be, like, super confident on a question ever. Where it's just like, it's always like in the next generation when Commander, oh God, no.
Well, he just knows what episodes suck.
Yeah.
There have been times where he gets the answer out before we even give the four choices.
Maybe I've just missed the wrong episodes, but but there's always a very amazing sense.
My favorite one is when I add a layer of complexity by not pronouncing any of the answers right. Those are my favorite days. So, Daryl, I just want to confirm, you're not wrong. This bag smells like a dentist's office.
Yes. Did you give Jared White one?
Yeah, I got one. All right, let me get my snout up in this bag.
Yeah,
here.
Get all up in there.
Oh,
okay. So while he's smelling it,
yes, Brian.
Coming from unofficial guest Corinne.
Yes.
Who really secretly wants to be on this show.
Right.
This is an old Pioneer candy, Brigham Young's favorite, supposedly.
Yep.
Not made in Utah anymore, but worth trying as a historical exercise. P.S. I hate it.
Yeah, it's supposed to be, some people love it, like adore it, and some people really don't like it. Says soothing for the throat, made with 100% natural whorehound. What the hell's a whorehound? Herb tea brewed.
How many whorehounds had to die for us to get this candy?
It says brewed and steeped in copper kettles. Steeped?
Yeah.
What is a steeping?
Steeping is just leaving things somewhere.
Yeah, basically it's when you put something in hot water and leave it. Steep your tea.
That's dumb.
Exactly.
Like a Whopper.
17.
You steep a Whopper in a toilet, yes.
Someone left another steeping Whopper in the toilet.
There we go.
Nice job, Daryl.
Stump a zing. I like it.
So we're going to try it. I mean, we'll try anything on the show. Let's give it a shot, and she'll be laughing at us. So here we go. Ready? Taste it.
I kind of like it.
I'm not sure it tastes like anything.
I haven't gotten any flavor yet.
Yeah.
This is going downhill.
It does seem like it's going weird, doesn't it?
Sweetness.
Oh! As soon as you get through the layer of sugar,
man,
on
what is that in the middle? Is that the whorehound part?
Oh, you can taste the whorehound.
I'm not hating it yet.
Oh yeah, it's starting to change now.
Oh, you know what? I'll bet Brian likes these because I'm still getting a black licorice vibe.
Like a black licorice?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, no, because Corinne loves black licorice. Remember, we talked about that this last week.
She's racist though. She didn't know.
Once you go black licorice.
We never go.
She thinks it's bigger than red licorice.
You never go back licorice. Back licorice is bad.
No. Good God.
Stuff that grows right out of your back.
Oh, yeah. I don't mind this at all.
You know what? I'm not hating it either. This isn't too bad. Brian, yeah. So once again.
It's not a strong flavor, though, at all. Mm-mm.
Oh.
I mean, I don't like it enough to go on a mission or anything, but.
I'm just trying to picture Brigham Young and the walking into the valley, because you know the old story, right?
He stomps his cane down and says, "Right here."
He says, "This is the place." Yeah, he goes, "This is the place." And we have like a "This is the place" monument downtown. You probably saw the statue of him pointing. It used to be pointing to somewhere, but now it's pointing to the freaking bank. Like,
yes.
This is the place where I keep my money and my savings.
My high yield interest rates.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to picture him doing that with this in his mouth. I actually kind of like that. I might eat more of those.
Yeah.
All right, Corinne, take that.
It's not bad. Like, just, you know.
We got more from her.
There, when you're not on microphone, just sitting.
This is the place in my mouth when I eat my whorehound candy.
Call it and get it by name.
So, hello, ladies and gentlemen. It's me, Brigham Young. Your old pal.
Your old buddy, Brigham Young. Daryl, how many lights are there?
Two.
There are four lights.
Incorrect.
Oh,
okay. That was your bonus question for the day. Actually, it's two bonus questions. Now, let's move on to birthdays. Any Trek birthdays worthy of mention?
Oh, yes. We have Wendy Noose. She is 58 today. She was producer, post-production supervisor, associate producer, co-producer on TNG and Voyager.
Wow. Not bad on her resume.
Back in 2000, she married Patrick Stewart, and then 3 years later, they called it quits.
Oh, really?
Aw.
Is he married now, Patrick Stewart? Do we know? Do we care? I probably don't care.
Married to the baller life.
Yeah. All right. Daryl, let's ask your question one more time. Actually, I'm not going to say these names again because I can't do it right. Cyalodin.
That's exactly why you should say them again.
Polysaccharide. Chlorinide.
Chlorinide.
Chlorinide. And what's the last one, Brian?
Acetylchlorine.
Damn it.
Or acetylcholine. There's no R in there.
Why don't you just go to... Seriously.
Why don't you just go to space medical school,
Brian? Yeah, space medical school. All right, Daryl, what do you say? What do you think?
Okay. I'm going to... Well, C sounded familiar, so... I think I'll go with that, whatever that was.
Chlorinide?
Is that what that was?
Yeah, that's what it was.
It's chlorinide.
Oh, what was
Jim?
B then?
B was polysaccharide.
Well, that's something like in candy, isn't it?
It's a Six Flags ride that nobody cares about anymore.
I think we might be sucking on it right now.
Yeah.
Acetylcholine.
Oh, that sounds dangerous.
Settle your colon is what it is.
Yeah. Well, especially before you get into the old Whopper room.
That's right. The Whopper room.
Maybe I should just stay with C.
You want to go with C? All right. Let's find out from the judges. Judges, is it C?
Pro bono.
Oh, Daryl, you blew your perfect week. It's the A, Cyalodin or whatever. McCoy says it's this word, and the dead bodies they see, they all see, is from the mass suicide. That's a weird sentence, Mike. Yeah, you sent that to us.
An R. R from a mass suicide. But
in this episode, a group of children are under control of some...
Now.
Yeah. Let's see. The children are under the control of some sort of spirit that takes over the Enterprise. It also features a kid ordering ice cream from a replicator and making this racist comment. Here is your clip for the day. Check it out.
It's coconut and vanilla. They're both white.
Racist.
And did you know the voice of Lucy from Peanuts was in that episode?
Was that her? Oh, maybe that was her.
I'm not sure.
Let's try it one more time. Listen for Lucy here. Let's try it one more time.
Blonde girl.
Let's see.
It's coconut and vanilla. They're both white.
That does sound like a...
It could be. It does sound like a Peanuts kid voice, doesn't it?
It sounds more like Linus.
Hold your football, you little dumbass. I can hear it. That's not bad.
Isn't that the true spirit of Christmas? Have we all forgotten coconut and vanilla are both white?
Shut up, Charlie Brown. You're a little butthole. That's the version I like. Do you know what? Did I tell you guys I'm going to interview his daughter, Charles Schultz's daughter? She lives like 10 minutes
away. I was very excited when you tweeted out you're going to interview the man himself.
I know what I said. I said, how would you guys like to hear an interview with Charles Schultz?
Like, well, Halloween's coming up. It's when the membrane between the world of the dead and the living is the thinnest.
Yeah. That's right. I can get to the other side this time. I'm going to find out why Snoopy started walking upright and how dumb that idea was. Anyway, yeah, I'll be talking to her. I don't know when and what, but...
That'd be great.
That'll be happening soon. Charlie Brown.
She has all this original stuff hanging on her walls that he drew. All worth a fortune. Just a
fortune.
You're going
to try and distract her and take something, aren't you?
Well, I heard she has this place called Alpine. Huge house. And she has a security system that is just beyond reproach. So I'm going to have a hard time stealing anything if I wanted to. So I'll just steal a kiss, a simple kiss.
Oh, there we go. Maybe just a little peck on the cheek.
Yeah, just a little bit. Daryl, I want to tell you congratulations for blowing it today. Good job. you've really outdone yourself. Tomorrow, though, you get a chance to just make it all go away with a final attempt for the week and go 3 for 4 in this week of our Lord. I don't know what day it is. So let's do that tomorrow. In the meantime, he is the Trek Nerd on Twitter. He is part of the show This Week in Trek at thisweekintrek.com. Yeah, Twit for short. That's right.
Yeah.
When Daryl leaves the show, he often tells us a little quote, and then we try to guess who did it. So, Daryl, who is it? What's you got? What are you doing? What are you doing? What do you got? Go.
Well, you're 2-0 this week so far. That's really good. So here's your chance to blow it just like I did.
Okay, good.
Seize the time, Maribor. Live now. Make now always the most precious time. Now will never come again.
Oh, my gosh. Mm. Maribor? Is this a main character, or are you throwing me some loop like it's the Tanagra guy or something?
Oh, it's a main character.
When the walls
and work
fell.
And we're together. There's three of you now. You can get this.
All right.
Can we even figure out from that line whether it's a TNG original series?
Yeah, do that, because we always tell you what series it's in, so you have to tell us.
Okay.
Oh, I was...
Which one?
TNG.
TNG.
All right. Can we get the quote one more time? Sorry.
Yeah, one more time.
Chicken shit money.
Go ahead.
Seize the time, Maribor. Live now. Make now always the most precious time. Now will never come again.
Gosh, who talks like that?
That sounds like it could be Picard.
How much Star Trek do you watch?
It's poetic. It's poetic like Picard, but it also has like the stilted.
The
stilted dialogue.
Yeah.
Well, that's just me saying it.
No. Oh, okay.
I mean, Guinan never had that much of a line, did she?
No.
It sounds like something she'd say.
Guinan.
Opa Guinan style.
Guinanology. All right, I'm going to say it was Data.
I'm going to say Picard.
I'm going to back Brian and say Picard.
Okay.
Okay, so it's 2-1 Picard. That's the one I'm going with. And you're right, it was Picard.
Yeah!
From the Inner Light.
Congratulations!
Oh, that's a good episode.
Sure. You're a winner!
The flute episode.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The flute, the 20-minute Lifetime episode where he plays the flute. That's actually one of the best episodes ever, and it won a Hugo Award. Multiple Hugo Awards, I think. So, nice job, Daryl. I should have known that. Why did I think it was Daryl?
Oh, nice job, you.
Well, they, you mean, not you. Daryl, fantastic. Fair voyages, and I'm going to hang up on you now unceremoniously. There you go.
Goodbye. Bye, Daryl.
News time.
Oh! News is brought to you by the NSFW Show, most Tuesdays on the Twit Network.
Wow.
Wow, really?
Yeah, you're part of that.
I am.
That's a thing you do. You
I'm
did
on
one,
that show.
You did it 2 days ago, though, right?
We did a show with Padre S.J., the Father Robert Palliser of This Week in Enterprise Tech, and it turned into like kind of a more of an interview episode where we talked about why he has become kind of a rogue, sassy-talking Jesuit priest.
Yeah, I'm really kind of interested in that. I need to catch that episode because he is a weird egg to me. Like
he's amazing. He's an amazing human being. And really, like, a lot of it, and you know, a lot of it is because, you know, me and Brian are obviously, you know, kind of similar theological minds and everything. And I think a lot of our audience tends to be as well. But we know that there's a wide variety of people that watch us. And, you know, I learned a lot about, you know, just the Jesuits, like, as a concept and him as a person. And it was super fun, and it was a really ridiculous episode. And I was actually, me and Brian were in studio for it, and at one point I tried to grab his crank. So that's a thing that you guys can go
watch. His crank.
Well, all right.
Slang for penis.
Yeah, well, as a joke, so I was doing a read for mailroute.net.
Okay. Right. Like you do.
Course, Yeah, you can stop spam and everything. And so I was spam, and he was an inbox, and we were showing what happens before mail route gets to you, and it got really grabby.
Wow. All right. Well, on that note, that's good information. Actually, I will check that out, because I think he's interesting, and he's going to win the freaking movie draft.
Yes. Well, it depends. I don't know. You got Bond, right?
Yeah, I did.
Bond might make all the money.
This weekend. Bond, everybody go see Skyfall. By the way,
Is that this weekend?
See if the weekend it comes out, which will be next week.
I thought it was this weekend.
No, this weekend Flight Halloween comes out.
You know what this will be, you guys? This will be the last movie I see with my bad eye.
Oh, yes. Take your eye back, Gotham.
Take your eye back. It must be more severe.
Yeah, I get my eye out that Wednesday. My eye out. I'm getting cataract surgery that Wednesday to fix my left eye's stupidness. And so this will be the last movie I see with the Gaussian blur that is my left eye.
Gotcha.
The Vaseline pile of poo that is in my left eye socket. So that'll be good. Anyway, so news. Let's do some news. So the Apple, big Apple announcement yesterday. I just wanted to touch on this stuff since we all are Apple enthusiasts.
Sure.
iPad mini is a thing. That happened. But there was a ton of stuff shown. So they got this 13-inch Retina MacBook Pro, which everyone
kind of... Big surprise.
People sort of expected it. That one was coming.
No, the iMac?
Yeah. No. The Retina MacBook Pro, the 13-inch.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, the bump to that. That seemed like a normal, natural thing. The iMac thing came out of nowhere. Nobody knew they were going to update that thing. And holy crap, it looks sexy.
Yeah, it does, yeah. Except I still get so many CDs from bands and labels. There's no way I could go without... Well, I mean, I'd have to get the external,
thing,
optical, but
I know. Yeah. We are facing that new age, though, Brian. It's going away. We're done. We're done with that. But here's my... I have no problem with that new announcement. I have no problem with the fact that it looks amazing and that one day I'll have some form of that probably. But I just bought an iMac about 3 months ago, and it's a nice kind of top-end, decked-out one that I needed for work reasons. Mm-hmm. For stuff I do with podcasting, mostly for the art. So that's been fine. It's been great. Well, I'm a little disappointed that I missed out on the new model. A little bit, right? But whatever, I'll wait for, a couple of years and we'll see how things go. It's fine. It's not that big a deal. But Phil Schiller, Apple's Phil Schiller, who I like a lot, gets up there and he says these following words. He shows you now, he says, now let's compare the old model to the new model, and he shows these two pictures.
Yeah.
And then makes this crack. He says, isn't it amazing how new stuff makes old stuff look like garbage, or whatever his words were?
Yeah.
And Scott, I just went, Phil, right? Dude, people bought that 6 months ago, and you're telling them what garbage they have.
Well,
now.
This is like, and it was, you saw it with the iPhone,
right?
When the 4S compared to the 5, especially in the weight and how it looked and how much thinner it was.
Sure.
Really, it was charitable for him to even say that new stuff in general, and not like new stuff that we make, that we specifically, like, we don't release something unless on some level you have a visceral reaction to, wow, this looks better than the last.
This is so much better than the last. Last one looks so awesome until right this second.
Yeah, right. Yeah, unless it's a bump in specs or something where the it doesn't look different. But whenever they change it, it's always a big radical physical change for the better or the different. The more sexy.
So, Brian, you're going to run out and buy an iPad mini? What are you going to do?
No, I do want to see one. I want to actually go to an Apple store and hold one in my hands and just see, how the new form factor feels.
Yeah.
But it's going back to the iPad 1, iPad 2 resolution, the 1024 by 768.
Yeah. And that wasn't very good, but I understand the price reasons for that, but that's made me
sad. They got to compete at that at the sub-400 level.
Yeah. They kind of have.
I said it yesterday, and I'll say it again. I'm perfectly happy with the size of my current iPad 3. I really like when I watch a movie on there. Like if I'm laying in bed and I want to watch a movie, boom, I get a nice, decent sized movie on there. I've got a big screen for reading comic books. I've got a good sized screen for photos and stuff like that. I don't think the size is targeted towards my use.
Well, in my thought, when I saw it, I went. Immediately, I said, you know what? Brian's going to be happier with the current size because his collection of hardcore pornography is much more viewable on the bigger screen.
Exactly. Like being able to zoom into those cracks and crevices like you can on the iPad 3.
Hey, you just admitted that you like the fatty porn.
I also like the idea that you are just zooming in to a nearly unintelligible resolution. Like,
that's right, exactly.
Exactly.
I like my porn to be abstract and indeterminate of what the hell I'm looking at.
I'm pretty sure that's an armpit.
Yep, could be a toe knuckle. Not sure.
Now, let me just say this. I don't know what my use case would be for the iPad mini, but I also didn't know what my use case was going to be for the iPad.
Yeah.
You know, and what I've kind of found in terms of how I use it is it's for me, like, I had my MacBook, and then I was able to just drag a window of functionality, like, physically off my desktop and into a physical thing.
Mm.
And I've very much enjoyed, you know, letting my MacBook now become more of a workhorse for things that only it can do, like uploading stuff or downloading stuff, or, you know, when I export podcasts and everything now, I can, instead of making that, you know, that process slower by also screwing around on my computer because I also want to be doing stuff, yeah. I can have the iPad.
Yeah. No, I'm with you. I'm with Brian. I want to go and hold one because I think then use case will start coming to me. It'll be like, this would be nice in bed when I want to just read.
Well, and that's
if I traveled more, maybe.
We are in a market now where, you know, I mean, remember when the iPad came out, it was a gray area. People didn't know, you know, I think the chattering class, you know, including ourselves and people who talk about tech a lot, you know, really didn't know whether people were going to want it because it was halfway between an iPhone and a MacBook.
Yeah,
they called
it a big iPod Touch is what it was. Yeah. That was the big tripey thing to say.
And then meanwhile, it not only is a gigantic, most, you know, super popular device, but changes computing. You know, as now, you know, I think they pointed out that they've sold more iPads than they have in a comparable amount of time. Like, Dell has sold computers. So what I think has changed over the last 2 years is that now we're in a mindset where people who have iPads love their iPads so much that we're in a two-tablet kind of, we're in an emerging two-tablet kind of space.
Right.
It's like, well, yeah, I have my iPad, but also I kind of want my Kindle or I want my Nexus 7. And now the iPad mini is there, you know, most notably where it can have an LTE. You know, it can get an always-on connection.
Yep.
If you're into that, which I love on my iPad 3.
Screaming.
And it shares, I mean, it has the advantage that no other smaller tablet has, which is just iOS.
Yeah, all the app ecosystem and all those apps being ready at day one and all that stuff is big. I don't know. I just have to wait and see. I just want to get my hands on it and play with it.
What I was excited about from the thing yesterday was the Fusion Drive.
Oh, yeah, that is really interesting, isn't it?
On the iMac, right?
Yeah, and I think it's... it was iMac only to start with, but I'm sure that thing will roll out to other stuff. But this idea
I'd like to see that get rolled out. I think it's
the new Ivy Bridge chipset that Apple's doing for all their stuff now.
Yeah, it's crazy that you can take a flash drive, combine that with a traditional, you know, slow drive, and have those things work in such concert that it looks like one logical drive and boost the performance in that way. That's crazy to me.
Yeah.
Totally cool. It also makes me slightly nervous. Like, that kind of stuff, when you're starting to mess with the way drives work, makes you worry about your data a little bit. But it's a cool idea. So, it's like a hybrid car.
Seamlessly transfers the stuff that you use the most to flash. Right.
That's pretty cool.
And the stuff that you don't use a lot to your hard drive, so it'll boot up faster.
Yeah, and some people in the chat room are reminding us that this isn't brand new tech. We know. It just hasn't. Yeah. Nobody's implementing it as a standard feature in their stuff that they sell, like a curated feature. So it's interesting in that regard. But I just don't know quite how I feel about it. To me, it's like a hybrid car. I really want to go full electric. Hybrid feels like a middle step to me. This feels like a weird middle step between this and when we can finally have really high capacity, very efficient flash SSDs. Drives that aren't expensive.
Yeah, sure.
And so this is like this weird in-between step. But anyway, that's all fun and good. You can learn all you need to know. Look at the video on apple.com. There's a whole bunch up there. Let's move on to something that pissed me off.
Okay.
U.S. Senator candidate Richard Murdoch. Yes. Murdoch!
I didn't hear this.
He says rape was intended by God in a debate.
It's a very, I mean, it's a... It's
Do you
a,
have a clip?
No, I got a clip.
Foot-in-mouth statement.
There. Yeah, it's foot firmly, like all the way up to his knee. Yes. Got an email from somebody who said, "Hey, whiskey and water, thought you might like to hear yet another politician sticking his foot in his mouth. This happened last night in my home state of Indiana. If this guy wins, I think I'll move. Love the show. Jason. So here is the clip of dude saying terribly inappropriate thing. Now, I just want to preface this by saying I am not going to excuse this dude's stupid comment, but he's at a debate. He's on camera. He's in front of a bunch of people. I think I kind of know what he kind of meant, but that's the problem with this saucy thing. It'll speak to itself.
Let's just let him.
Yeah, it'll speak for itself. There it is.
You know, this is that issue that every candidate for federal or even state office faces, and I, too, certainly stand for life. I know there are some who disagree, and I respect their point of view, but I believe that life begins at conception. The only exception I have for to have an abortion is in that case of the life of the mother. I struggled with it myself for a long time, but I came to realize life is that gift from God, and I think even when life begins in that horrible situation of rape, that it is something that God intended to happen.
Ah! It's the last pit. It's the part at the end.
You want to know what? The funny thing is, like, you know, you could have stopped just right. He had a very a very, like, pro forma, pro life candidate answer there.
Mm-hmm.
That you know, I understand some people
perfectly
disagree.
Acceptable.
You it's know, a, I believe in pro life. The only thing is in the health of the mother. Leave it there.
Stop right there.
That answers your question. Don't need to go any further.
And he was clearly, I mean, he's getting a little emotional, I guess, at the end. Maybe he was just running out of air. I don't know what was happening there. But he was kind of, feels like he was kind of breaking apart a little bit at the end. Sometimes we say things we don't mean when we get in that state. But what a freaking doozy, dude. Say goodbye to your
really
stupid campaign.
And it's just his phrasing. I mean, obviously, he's meaning that the life is what God intended, not the rape is what God
But he's
intended.
Still wrong. But, like, if you're going to make the exception, here's my problem with it.
Yeah.
And that's why everyone, it's so funny, because even in our conservative state, we talked about this a bunch, which is predominantly an LDS state.
Yes.
I shouldn't say that. The city, Salt Lake City, is actually way skewampus the other way, but the rest of the state goes back the other way, so the average is pretty high. But anyway, the bottom line is, the official church stance is, don't like abortion, but in the case of health of the mother, rape or incest.
Yes, three. That's usually the big.
In the South, they hate our freaking guts for that. They think that up here we're a bunch of liberal rebels for thinking like that's so far from the from the hardcore right stance of under any circumstances or whatever. Well, this guy's clearly taking that any circumstances thing, but he's got the health of the mother thing down.
Yeah,
I would argue that it's bad for the health of the mother if she's dying on the operating table or. If she was raped!
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, this is... Part of this is a policy issue, you know, where he does... Like you said, there is a difference between pro-life candidates that, you know, have that big three bullet point exception to the abortion no-no. This guy clearly thinks there's it's a one-point plan.
Yeah.
You know, he just phrased it awkwardly. I mean, when you have an issue like that, so much of how you get elected is how you talk about it. And he chose poorly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, entirely poorly. And I would say this of him. Here's what I say about candidates who say stupid things because it helps our show.
They're swell.
That's right. I like those guys.
And also, it's like, you know, at the end of the day, after the whole Todd Akin thing, let's lay off the rape talk.
Yeah.
Guys, like... Yeah, right. It's not.
Have we not learned from Todd Akin? Yeah,
exactly. I mean, that dude got blown up to a national story.
Yeah,
but just
it's huge.
Just
yeah.
Dance around. Just don't say R. Don't say the R word.
It's his election's the same week as general election, right?
All elections.
The Akin guy, all that stuff.
Yeah, same day.
I'm really anxious to hear how it is.
Because Akin didn't drop out, right?
No, he stayed.
He's still running.
Yeah, hardcore. Yeah.
What a tart.
He is a complete tart.
He's got a legitimate campaign.
Yeah, that's right. Very legitimate. Let's move on to this right here.
If communists have attempted to inject their propaganda into the motion picture, they have failed miserably.
Hey, look, it's Celebrity Poop, and it's brought to you by...
Kim's Jambalaya.
There are men who kill for this stuff.
That was really good. Mm. You can concur. It was good.
Oh, my God. It was amazing.
Yeah. I'm having leftovers when I get back from my meetings today.
You want to know what is also something, if you ever come and visit the Johnson household... Mm. only wine glasses.
Yeah, that's true.
No actual glasses, only wine glasses. Everyone drinks out of a wine glass. Yeah. The kids, the dog.
Everybody.
It's an amazing experience.
We got rid of all the stupid glasses you have in the house, and we got, I don't know what she has. She got some deal at Kohl's or something, and we just have nothing but wine glasses.
I felt so classy.
Yeah, it was pretty nice. Let's get to an early review of Skyfall. It's according to Forbes.com. They usually talk about money.
Oh, Forbes?
Yeah, Forbes.
Reviews movies?
Yeah.
It just, oh! Oh, Skyfall. Skyfall.
They really like it. They really like it. So Skyfall is a James Bond movie, which means it has the requisite number of exotic locations, heart-pounding chase scenes, balletic. They mean ballet-like fight choreography. Balletic is the way you'd say that?
Yeah.
That sounds like a disease.
Balletic. You heard it a lot with, like, The Matrix.
After
you know?
I had lupus, I came down with a balletic condition where I had a really big crotch and I tiptoed everywhere. Anyway.
Reminds us of our guest on NSFW this week, Father Robert Balletic.
That's right. And gadgetry, director Sam Mendes, who I like, did the first one, right? Or did Casino Royale?
He did American Beauty.
Oh, right, with the girl with the flowers on her belly.
Nina Savary.
That's the one.
And, of course, Road to Perdition.
Yeah, oh, I love Road to Perdition.
Always left off. Great
based on
comic
book movies. Yeah, comic
always,
book movie.
No one talks about that, yeah. But that movie was great.
Fantastic movie. Holy crap, let's go watch that right now. Anyway, it mostly eschews the high-tech toys this time. But the last two, he didn't have any high-tech toys, really.
Yeah,
Fills the void with moral complexity. Fine, but the last two were not. They were definite departures from the whole evil guy has webbed feet and Bond has a watch that'll shoot a laser through somebody's head.
It was less of a cartoon, you know.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I think there was still some tech in it, but like shock and horror, they were all used for a very specific reason in the plot, mm-hmm. and not just like, well, Bond, I have this time got you a laser shooting bagel.
Perfect for those times, but they are reintroducing Q.
Yeah,
in this,
no longer John Cleese.
Yeah, it'll be some young dude.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm excited. Brian, you're gonna go?
Oh hell yeah!
Yeah.
Love me some James Bond.
Look, I'm not here to promote my winter movie draft chances, but I would really like people to go see Skyfall twice or three times.
I'll tell you what, I went to go see Looper, and they played the newest Skyfall trailer before it, and I hadn't seen it before, but the whole idea of like Bond being dead and then coming back and you don't know why he came back, like if you would have told me that Skyfall was playing in another room but there was no door, I would have tried to run through the
just
wall.
Just get over there and go in there.
I would have tried to just run repeatedly headlong into the wall until it broke and I could see the movie.
Or go back in time, kill what's his name? I think it was his name. Joseph Gordon-Levitt. Then go over there.
Exactly.
Have your own little looping experience.
It looks amazing.
Yeah.
Like, for beyond the movie draft, I am so excited to go see it. And the fact that, like, all of the reviews are, like, best Bond movie ever.
Mm-hmm.
Which, I mean, like, Bond, obviously, you know, a beloved character.
Yeah.
You know, the movies are fun to watch. But never one to be thought of as, like, great cinema.
No.
Casino Royale was great.
Yeah, I loved it.
Quantum of Solace, not so much.
You know what? Back to back, still great. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you right now, you watch those two movies back to back. I know it sounds like
together.
Sounds like totally. A tropey thing people tell you sometimes. Yeah. Oh, just do them all together. It's like one movie. It's actually true in that case.
Well,
it's weird how good it is in the second.
I'm so thrilled to see this, and I think the idea and Sam Mendes has talked about he had no interest in doing a Bond movie until he saw Nolan's Dark Knight, and he was like, "Oh, okay, well." You can do something that's very, very popular and involves these like popular, interesting characters and actually take them in these morally complex, interesting places and do kind of this new, we're in this very interesting period of like big budget art house movies.
You know,
you have these art house guys that are getting these gigantic budgets and we're seeing, especially in pictures that, you know, nerds like us are really into, some great work. So I'm thrilled to see Mendes' take on Bond.
How do you feel about... Just this, I'm just going to mention this here. So, Brian, were you going to see Cloud Atlas, Brian? I can't remember if that had interest to you.
Absolutely. Very interested. Especially, I read a really cool recap of the book that didn't give any spoilers, but it kind of said, all right, here's the premise of the book. It's like, oh, okay, this sounds really cool.
It's pretty neat sounding. And I haven't read the book, and I think Tom's in the middle of reading it and says it's awesome. But you had said during the winter movie draft plans that I think it was you, said that you thought that thing was going to go straight down the middle critically. And so far, you're about right. 66%, a little better than half, but that seems like it's going to be a movie people love or don't like.
You know,
A lot of money.
The word
is
on it, and I thought it was going to be less than that critically, because some of the reviews coming out of the film festivals were very negative on it and thought that it was, you know, way too muddled and didn't make a whole lot of sense, and ultimately it was just kind of a big pretty thing with no actual point to it. The book apparently was a very challenging source material to film. You know, it was kind of oftentimes thought of to be the unfilmable kind of book. So, you know, we will see, but it's gotten better critical reaction, and always check on Rotten Tomatoes for the movie draft. Check how many people want to see it.
Oh, it's that 98%.
Yeah,
Let's see. Is that what that means?
Yeah, up in the top next to the tomatometer. Right. You get the how many people
there it is, yeah.
Want to see it.
Yeah. Oh, want to see it? Well, yeah. 98% of people want to see it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that should be a raw number below that.
It says user ratings 28,266. So that many people want to go see it. Is that high? Is that good?
Well, you check it to other movies that are coming out around that time, but that seems good to me. And it seems like people, you know, are really, really pumped to see it, and chicks want to see it, which is always a big driver for movies in the fall and winter.
Wreck-It Ralph, 98% want to see it, 15,613.
So less.
Yeah, less. So who knows, dude? Who knows? This whole thing, movies. We're going to take a break. Before we do, tweakedaudio.com sponsoring the show. Go get yourself replacement earbuds. Have them sound good. Spend less money. Use Stream at checkout for 33% off for TMS listeners. You want good engineered durability stuff. You want it to work with all your phones, even those weird freaking Android things you picked up. These are great for that as well. Noise reduction all around. Lifetime warranty. Go to tweakedaudio.com. And again, that code is STREAM at checkout for 33% off. We thank our friends at Tweaked Audio. Brian, let's play a song before we get to Nicole and Tom. What do you got?
Sounds good. This one comes from Dustin Anderson, or this request comes from Dustin Anderson. Dear old BNS, Tuesday, October 23rd will mark the 10th anniversary of my wonderful wife deciding to put up with me on a permanent basis. To celebrate, I would love for you guys to play a song for us, hence the request email. I wrote back in June to request a song for her birthday, and just a follow-up, she's made an almost full recovery from her illness. So, she loves the movie Grease, and I faintly remember the Megamix was playing that summer that we met. I know it came out like way before, 5 years or so, but we met at a scout camp in the summer, therefore that song sticks in my head. If you can't play that song or a good cover, please find a good song that she would like from the Grease soundtrack. I leave it in your capable hands, dear brain. Don't disappoint. Not like you have in the past or anything. Vicky, here's to another 40 or so years if the kids don't kill us before then. Thanks, guys. Despite your constant ramblings, I still tolerate the noise you put out. Oh. Signed, Dustin Anderson.
Thanks, man.
Thanks, Dustin.
Yeah, I got no covers of the Megamix, the Grease Megamix. That's kind of an amalgamation in and of itself. However, I do have a great cover of one of the songs from Grease that I thought would be perfect for today. Summer Lovin', you know, that song that Sandy and Danny sing.
Tell me more.
Separately.
Tell me more.
That's the one right there. The Vandals put out a cover of it, and this is kind of one of those odd covers where they change the lyrics. And because of that, I actually recommend that if you're listening to the show on the podcast, you know, time shifted, go out, pause it right now, and find the lyrics to this and read the lyrics as you listen to the song. For those of you in the tadpool, I'll just paste a link for you right now. Because the lyrics to this thing are different from the original, and they're hilarious.
Okay.
Here is the Vandals and their sort of cover of Summer Lovin'.
Fantastic. Summer Lovin', everybody. When we come back, Tom Merritt will be here. Before that, Nicole Spagnolo talking about movies. Stay tuned.
Drifted away to the summer night. Right now, Loblaws is having a huge frozen food sale. You can get tremendous value on over 50 frozen food items, frozen vegetables, frozen meat entrees, frozen concentrated juices, ice cream. If it's frozen, you can save plenty. Don't get left out in the cold. Come on in and stock up that freezer. Loblaw's frozen food sale. Another reason why more than the price is right. Does he work here?
We are probing Luton's compound deeply with our sensors now.
The Morning Stream, where something funny, 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 snark, snarky, snark.
Welcome back, everybody. Cool song. Nice little break song there, Brian.
Yeah, a little unexpected.
I like it.
That was great. Yeah. And I got the lyrics and I read them. And they were hilarious.
Yeah.
Yes.
Pretty well done.
Changes it up from a summer romance to what happens on tour.
Rock bands. Yes.
Yeah, it's perfect. Why not take your Grease song and ruin it? But in a good way.
A good ruining.
Hey, it's time for us to call Nicole. She is here for recommendals, probably, most likely. It's a good chance. I feel pretty good about it. Let's give her a shot and see what we can do here. Hold on a second. There we go. She looks green. That means she's probably here. Let's find out.
I think she probably did something she shouldn't.
Yeah, maybe. Looking a little green. Oh, look who it is, everyone. It's recommendals time. And
it's so much later in the day. I wonder why.
Isn't that weird?
You must have a special guest or something.
Oh, sure. Blame it on me, Spags.
Freezing. It's like cold tar running uphill on a winter day in here with Justin over there. No, I'm surprised we're not running longer than we are.
I had to take an opportunity to give him crap.
That's all right.
Know.
What's Tuesday doing on Wednesday?
That's how she do.
Yeah, exactly. This is
East. I've gotten hate texts from Bill Durand about how I've switched sides to Wednesday.
Exactly. All day affair, too. So, Nicole, it's good to have you back. How are you?
Yeah, it's been a while. Yeah. We missed last week, but I got a lot of movies.
Yeah, I've been stacking up. Well, let's get started. What do you have for number one recommendal?
Well, I hear it's going to be Halloween soon, so I thought I would go with some scary movies this week.
Ooh, very nice. That's exciting.
So, the first one's not going to be scary, but it does have a werewolf in it.
Ah, a werewolf. I love me some werewolves.
Werewolf, no. it's the 1985 film Teen Wolf.
Oh, Teen Wolf with the...
it's streaming. I love it.
With the Michael J. Fox. It's so much better than the second one with...
No. Don't watch the second one.
Jason Bateman.
And it's not the MTV TV show. These young kids need to understand that is not Teen Wolf.
You know what I've heard, though? I've heard that show's all
right. People love that show.
Yeah, I hear it's okay.
I know, but I...
I'm with you, though, Nicole.
Michael J. Fox.
Yeah, we need to preserve history and call a spade a spade here. And what we've got is the right Teen Wolf with Michael J. Fox. Does it hold up? I'm a little worried. I'd tune in and it'd be a little goofy now.
Yeah. I think it's great. I still watch it.
Mm. I'll tell you what, a little companion reading for Teen Wolf. Mm. McSweeney's did a very, very funny thing on the opposing coach's pregame breakdown of Teen Wolf in basketball.
Really?
Yeah, and like it was like a scouting report, like that they would read before the game to see like the strengths or weaknesses of Teen Wolf's play. Oh,
that's perfect.
And it's
did
very,
you ever
very funny.
See the last scene, the hidden scene about the guy showing his
wiener?
What?
In Teen Wolf.
It's in the bleachers at the very end. They win the big game.
Oh, right. It's one of those things. It's Snopes. I remember this. And Snopes says it's real.
It's real. I've seen it.
Wiener.
Pulls his crank out?
Yeah.
What?
His crank, as you say in Florida or wherever it is you come from.
I don't know if it's in the streaming version, but I know it's there. I've seen it. I had an old copy and we put it in.
It's gone wild.
I'm looking this up. This might be dangerous with the image search, but I'm going to try it anyway. Oh, yeah, there it is.
What? Tilt that camera. So, tilt that over.
That's hilarious.
Okay, here's the screen grab. Let me pull it over here so you can see it. Oh, it's just hard to see it. It's an animated GIF. Look. Guy pulls out his... Look.
I told you.
That is awesome. And that's in the movie. So it's in the one you saw?
Well, I had an older copy on DVD. I'm not sure if it's in the streaming version.
I would imagine
they edited that out.
I freaking love that that's a thing still.
I'll tell you what,
great.
He pulled his little popcorn shrimp out there.
for anybody that's seen the Teen Wolf movie when it first came out.
Man, there aren't enough beans there with those Franks, if you know what I'm saying.
No, someone's got a license to sell hot dogs.
Woo! All right, well, everyone go watch Teen Wolf and try to spot that scene if you can. What's number two? What do you got?
All right, I'm sticking with the 80s theme here. 1986 film, House.
Oh,
not yeah, the, t- the one not with the TV show.
With the doctor that complains and limps around a lot. No?
William Cat. Oh,
with Greatest American Hero on
Greatest
there.
American Hero, which is why I sent you a message asking you if you had the theme for Greatest American Hero. Cause,
I think I do.
Believe it or not, I'm walking on air.
Wait, I'm going to find this. American Hero.
So now what is House about?
Okay, so House... It's about a house.
Okay, all right.
In the middle of our street?
Campy, it's kind of B movie. It feels, I don't know. You remember those old, like, 80s shows like Monsters and Tales from the Dark Side and things like that? Yeah. It's that feeling, I mean, but it's a movie.
I remember seeing this in the theaters. And
it's funny and it's campy hilarious. And and point this, scary. And there is a second one, too. The second one's even funnier than the first one.
This actually would have been a perfect film sack movie.
Oh, yeah, it would have been. Yeah. Is it streaming now or not streaming?
Yeah, it's streaming right now. House 1 and 2 streaming right now.
This isn't the house that has George Wendt in it from Cheers. Yeah, oh, it is
exactly
that one.
Which one it is.
Oh, mm-hmm. I've seen that. Yeah.
Norm.
That would be all right for a thing to watch. By the way, I couldn't find Greatest American Hero. I found Magnum P.I. instead. Just for the hell of it.
Oh, okay.
I have tons of TV themes. I don't know why I don't have that one. I've got everything and its dog in here. I have Starsky and Hutch. I have the Dragnet theme. I've seen Elsewhere, Gilligan's Island, Dynasty, Melrose Place, 6 Feet Under. It just goes on and on, but I don't have Greatest American Hero. That's stupid.
Well, let's wallow in your failure.
I have the greatest TV theme of all time, which is this. The old Battlestar Galactica theme is freaking fantastic. Anyway,
by the way, that's my favorite. Have you seen Argo yet?
No, I hear it's good.
It's very, very good. But they're walking around in like the Paramount backlot or whatever, and there's a couple old Battlestar Galactica Cylons like with their helmets off, just smoking and like talking. It's
really?
Just one of those like throwaway.
Oh, it's because the 70s.
Because the 70s, and they're talking to you know, the guy who did the makeup for Planet of the Apes helps them with all this.
That's awesome.
This whole scheme.
Okay, I like that. That's a nice little Easter egg. All right, Nicole, number three.
Yep. Well, I just want to say for Justin, House is a fun movie because weird things happen in it. In the second one, I think the rooms are all different, like, you know, things like a fish comes to life, a dead fish on the wall, and just weird, weird things. It's the house is possessed, and it kind of has a sick sense of humor, and it messes with the people in it. So,
awesome.
All right.
Yeah.
Very nice.
And my third and final are it's a pack. Creepshow 1 and Creepshow 2.
Oh, yeah.
Written by Stephen King. First one was written, screenwritten by Stephen King, directed by George
Romero.
Yeah.
Yes. We were just talking about him last night. Zombie Man. He does the zombies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Zombie Man.
I was really excited to see both of these movies streaming on Netflix. For some reason, though, I remember more of the Creepshow 2 stories. Because there are like five different stories kind of bundled up together, and each one, it's a short story. I mean, yeah, Stephen King is known
for a lot of
his short stories.
It's like the Twilight Zone movie. They break it up into these little vignettes.
Yeah, so if you've never seen Creepshow, watch Creepshow.
Yeah, watch the first Creepshow's got Stephen King with a bunch, like a chia pet.
Yes, it's Chia King.
Chia King, right.
The guy that finds the meteorite.
Yeah, and he gets all hairy green.
It also has Ted Danson in it.
Wow, look at all your Cheers theme, connections. Jeez.
I know. What's going on?
That's pretty impressive.
Cheers to Halloween with Nicole Spagnolo and her recommendals.
Here you go.
If only Shelley Long appeared in the first movie.
That's
from
right.
Teen Wolf.
I wish Hello Again was streaming.
Because just this music makes me happy. This
exactly.
This is the fish.
Whoa, movie. Yeah.
Anyway.
Imagine the spills, the creeps, the chills with all of... Your Cheers-centric horror.
Fantastic.
Kirstie Alley. Yeah.
She's scary just by herself.
She was hot when she was that Sarek chick in Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, but after that, kind of lost interest in her. Well, nice work, Nicole. These are all fine recommendals. Do you got anything you want to pimp this week? You got some family coming into town. That's exciting.
I do. Mateo's first birthday is this weekend.
Oh, wow.
Yay. Wow, that was Can you believe it's been a year?
Jeez.
Wow.
I know he'll never listen to this, but happy birthday, Matthew.
No, he may one day when checking out. He's going, look, he'll be like 50. You'll have been in cryogenic freeze for a good couple of years. And he'll be going, I want to know more about my mom and what she did when she was like in her 30s. So I'm going to go back and listen to all this terrible MP3 content for her Wednesday episodes. It'll happen.
Yeah.
You watch. Dude, my kids have.
And I would like to say, hello, 50-year-old Mateo.
What is it like in your future landscape? All right, Nicole. Well, have a fun awesome. Time. It sounds like a blast this weekend. And congratulations to the little guy.
It's going
to
be a great time.
I'm still pissed I haven't met the little dude yet, but it'll come.
You will. You will. We're going to try to bring him to Nerdtacular next year. Oh. Justin, you better be at Nerdtacular.
I'm there.
They're planning on it. Him
I'm
and
there.
Brian.
Yeah, no. Brian wants to get on it. But now that I'm on two Frog Pants shows, I think I'm legally obligated.
Yeah,
to.
It kind of has to now. And tomorrow, stay tuned tomorrow, I may have some early date information regarding the event. So I'm not going to say yet today until I get something worked out with Corinne, but I think tomorrow we'll be able to announce it. So stay tuned.
Yes.
Nicole, have right. a fantastic day.
Bye,
and follow her on Twitter. She's Nicole Spag, everybody.
Bye, Nicole.
Bye, Nicole. Bye. I must hang up on you now. How do
okay.
I do it?
Hang up.
Like that. That's how you do it. All right. Let's see if Ace Detect is truly there and online and ready for us.
Yeah,
oh, I need to have his thing ready though. Is it this one? Yeah. We'll do that one.
Okay.
We'll just go ahead and forecast that's what I'm going to do. Oh, see what I did there with forecast? Did you hear that?
Oh, too soon.
Pretty bad.
Too soon.
Pretty bad is what that is. All right. Oh, hey everybody, look who it is. It's Tom Merritt from Tech News Today and the Internet at large. Well, hello, Tom Merritt.
Well, if it isn't the fast-talking, gum-snapping Hollywood Tom Merritt.
Who the hell is that? That is that grating voice.
I know. I can't get it to stop. Something wrong with my mixer. I don't know what's going on. I kid.
I love the Justin Robert.
Of course. Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, the host of Tech News LA, Tom Merritt.
Tech News LA. I like that.
Yeah, Tech News LA. You know, some people may not have heard this. Eileen got an amazing, awesome job at YouTube at their new studios in LA, and you guys will be house hunting soon, right?
That's right. I'm quitting everything I do and just going to lay on the beach, drink rum, mm-hmm. and yeah.
Just kind of hang out and do what you got to do.
Become a Venice Beach bum. No, you're half of what you, the part that Scott. That said, is true. Eileen got a great job at YouTube. She starts in November. I'm not moving down there until after January, but you're right. We're all going to start house hunting here shortly. Despite every effort of Brian Brushwood to muddy the waters, nothing is changing for me other than I'll be on Skype for Tech News Today instead of sitting next to Sarah and Ayaz, but I'm continuing to do all the same things that I've been doing.
Yeah.
And it's going to be great. There's going to be, I think you guys are going to have a lot of opportunity to do a bunch of cool stuff with Tech News Today and I did, and listen, don't blame this all on Brian. I heard you on Tech News Today deliberately asking Chat Realm to go and spread rumors, which
I didn't do anything of the sort. Are you kidding me?
Okay. So there we go. So if you see, I saw many colorful rumors circulating, including that
frame rate saying, please go spread rumors.
That you were fired and Twit was hiring Conan O'Brien, yeah, right. Hashtag OMG Conan.
Yeah, yeah, of course. Well, the truth of it is, Brian, everything I know about Brian and Justin is if an opportunity presents itself to socially engineer a situation, they'll do it. So if they hear Tom's moving to LA, they'll go, okay, everybody who can hear us now, set your genitalia on fire and carve the words Ace Detect on your left butt cheek, you know?
Yeah.
Like, that's the way they roll.
So, I like the fact that character defamation falls into the term social engineering. I like that definition.
That's awesome. Well, Tom is, of course, still the host and will remain the host of Tech News Today, along with his fine co-hosts, Ayaz Akhtar and Sarah Lane. And it's a fantastic show. He comes here on Wednesdays.
Don't forget Jason Howe.
Yeah, well, Jason Howe, of course. I'm on there tomorrow, by the way, so I'll see you then.
Awesome.
You're also somebody who comes in here on Wednesdays, and we talk about the tech news of the moment, something you're prepping for today's show. Tom, what do you have today?
It's a quiet week, you know.
Anything happening?
Haven't done any announcements. Yeah. No new big new products launching anytime soon. Or, I don't know what to tell you, Scott.
Kind of dry.
Yeah, pick your poison. You want to talk about Apple's announcement yesterday? today? Do you want to talk about the Windows Surface reviews that came out?
I want the Surface thing.
Windows 8.
Yeah, because everybody's talking iPads and iPad minis and all that stuff, and it's been talked to death. I am dying to know about the Surface thing.
And I think in the context specifically, like, the begun these tablet wars have.
Yeah. You know, yeah. Like,
It is on like Donkey Kong now that everybody's in the game and now that people have actually touched the Surface.
Yeah. to not be that's a pretty good pun right there.
Yeah.
They've only touched the Surface.
Dip below the Surface.
Right.
And find out what's
But I haven't read the reviews. What are the reviews?
Yeah, what are we hearing?
The reviews are mixed. They're kind of all over the place, but generally my meta reading of them, which is really all I do. I don't do any work. I just read other people's work and then reinterpret it.
Sure.
My meta reading is that the hardware seems good. Everybody seems to agree, like, hey, this keyboard actually works really well. You know, maybe take some getting used to, but we like it. And you can actually get work done on this thing. And it's well designed, and it's a good solid piece of hardware. The software leaves some people cold. They're not exactly 100% sure. Some people say Windows RT is nice and productive. Other people have problems, say it's sluggish. Maybe gaming didn't work. So it sounds like Microsoft making the software for Windows RT worked great, but third-party apps maybe didn't work quite as great. So this goes back to what the Intel CEO Paolo Delini said, is they're going to be able to fix that after launch. So look for a bunch of patches and things to happen after October 26th. But the big negative is the App Store. Everybody's complaining that there just aren't any apps for this tablet. So when you're comparing it to anything, whether it's a full on desktop where you can, you know, get millions and millions of apps, or you're comparing it to an iPad which has 700,000 apps or whatever in the iOS App Store, it just lacks. You just can't get a lot of things to run.
Or
on
even
it.
Google's Play Store has, you know, more
yeah, yeah,
apps than
absolutely.
That.
And Google's got announcement coming up on Monday, October 29th, that will probably be about some new Nexus tablets. They're talking about a Nexus 10-inch, a new Nexus 7-inch. So, yeah, the tablet wars are very, very on, yeah. Almost exactly like Donkey Kong.
Yeah, and it's... that is to say, there is a princess in trouble and a giant monkey who is keeping you from her.
And an Italian caricature.
Okay, of course. Stereotypes all around. So, by the way, you could be Mario for Halloween there, Justin.
Maybe. I don't know.
Just
maybe
grow that mustache a little bit more. Say, let's a go, and you're set.
Or Aladdin.
Yeah, why not?
Or a Greek taxi.
Yeah, or anything where, you know, I wouldn't call you brown, but you're tanner than me.
All right, enough.
All right, so anyway.
We're getting the dangerous area.
So, Tom, this RT thing, which when I was in high school meant something very different. And
retweet?
I won't. No, it's something even worse.
Royal Tomato?
No, it had to do with when, if you just got out of the pool, sure, and you're in the cold air,
yeah,
and your nipples attain a certain rigidness,
sure,
we referred to that as RT, which was short for rock, and then the T word, which
teats.
Is terrible. I realize
rock
teats.
Yeah,
right.
That sounds like a B-52 song. Rock teats.
Rock teats. Get in your
car.
You
see a painted sign at the side of the road
that says "Rock tip left." I don't even know what that means. I just said it, didn't I? I didn't mean to say it. I was trying not to say it.
You said it. Now you said
it. Dang it. All right, sorry.
Sometimes the Fred Schneider will just bring it out of you.
I guess so.
So how you doing, Ibbott?
I'm hanging in there, too.
All right, but what my question was, so this new line of tablets, it does seem that this whole war, so let's call it a war and let's say it's on, it does seem to boil down to who has the biggest app store. And doesn't it seem like Apple needs to do all they can to shore up, like make whatever initiatives they need to make sure the App Store for iOS remains dominant, remains attractive to developers, that they retain that supposed 90% lead they have over the competition, or else things get real ugly real quick. And I don't feel like Microsoft's the bigger player here. I feel like it's Android's game to steal if they want. What do you make of all that?
It's the entire experience. I feel like the App Store advantage, I mean, definitely Apple wants to keep pushing that. They want the perception that if you don't get an Apple product, you're not going to have all the cool apps. And then they did that during their announcement yesterday. They talked about the number of apps and the huge number of things that you can get in the App Store. And so they're going to keep pushing that perception. the thing is, and they made a comparison with the Nexus 7 and showed the way it's like, well, they have these apps in Android, but look how ugly they are. And the fact is, that's just not true. They picked particular examples, and I was sitting there shouting, like, let's compare the Maps app. And I feel like the playing field is fairly level. What is true to me is that iOS gets the buzzy apps first, and whether that's deserved or whether that's just because Apple fanboys are very good at putting buzz out there, I don't know. But when a new path or an Instagram comes along, it tends to come to iOS first, and I think that's because developers feel like that's where they're going to get the most bang for their buck. So Apple's going to continue to press that advantage. But otherwise, you know, I think I use a Nexus 7 all the time, and I don't sit there anymore saying, gosh, I wish I had this app. All the apps I need to do the things that I do every day are all on there. I will say, though, that is the catch-up that Microsoft has to play, is they have to get to that point, and they're not there. When you pick up a Surface, it sounds like, from the reviews I'm reading, people are saying, not all the apps that I want to have on this tablet are here.
Yeah. Any interest in that Mini? Just curious from your own personal point of view?
No, for me?
Yeah,
nah.
Not really?
Nah, don't care.
Mm. And I know Eileen's pretty...
I really, really, really don't care.
Eileen's pissed it's not Retina. She's not happy about the fact
That's not my problem. I just, I'm like, right. I've got a 7-inch tablet I'm happy with, and I've got an iPad that's, you know, 10 inches, and I don't need it.
Yeah. But I think that's why that they needed to get into the game, is because, you know, I think we are, and we talked a little bit earlier in the show about, like, we are now kind of moving into a two tablet, like, where the idea of owning two tablets and using two tablets on a daily basis is not crazy. People can envision themselves doing it, and a lot of people do. So they would like them to be. Apple would want them to be two Apple tablets, you know?
I'm laughing because I caught myself the other day. I was walking from one room to another, and I realized that I had a glass of water, a laptop, a 7-inch tablet, a 10-inch tablet, and a phone in my hand. And I was taking them to all different places so that they would be conveniently placed to where I would need them for my
spreading them like a digital Johnny Appleseed.
Wow.
Yeah, but I think, you know, and also the idea of people who want a Apple tablet experience but don't want to spend the $500 to $600 for an iPad, now you can get a slightly cheaper option into it. But, you know, I'll tell you what, I think it's very interesting with the Surface, because, you know, if one of the advantages is, like, you can get real work done on it, the larger question is, do people want to get real work done on a tablet, or is it going to be like, hey, I can file taxes really well on this toaster?
Yeah. That's an interesting question, right? Like, how far can we take it? What types of machines will we be able to do stuff on? There are plenty of things I still cannot do on a tablet. I just can't. I have to have a laptop for it. But Tim Stevens said, you know what? You can be productive. He's from Engadget. He said, you can be productive on the RT, on the Surface RT. You snap that keyboard on, and it's like you're working on a laptop. So yeah. I'll be interested to see if that's true for most people.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I'd love to hear your thoughts when you actually get your hands on one and sort of play with one. I'm sure you've got something's coming to Twit. They're clearly, someone's going to order that, like Leo, or someone's going to buy one, right?
Yeah, Leo already ordered one. I'm sure a couple other people have ordered them. So I imagine I'll get a chance to see it. I didn't order one myself. I regret that now.
Yeah. You know, I'll be very curious to see what it does, because, you know, for Microsoft, I think this is the game that they should be getting into, and I hope that they do produce a really good tablet, because I think a lot of people who are, you know, that want to be in the Windows ecosystem deserve, you know, a piece of hardware that can allow them to do that, in the same way that, you know, Mac people can do that with iOS, where things just kind of work together.
Yeah, it seems like they have an advantage in that way, you know, or they could, if they really integrate those two ecosystems, that they could have a distinct advantage over everybody else in terms of volume.
The danger is that people look at this and say, "I don't want to run this on my desktop anymore, because it's too weird."
Yeah,
I'm not saying that will happen, but that's the risk.
Yeah, that's true. Tom Merritt, outside of the world of the tablets, what is going on in your life you'd like to pimp today before we cut you off unceremoniously?
Did I mention I had created a Squarespace site for all my books?
No. Do tell. Where is this?
Meritbooks.squarespace.com. Obviously, the chronology of tech history that I just wrote and put out is front and center on the site. But it's got links to the purchasable and free versions of all my stuff. So just check it out. Meritbooks.squarespace.com.
I was actually looking because I wanted to buy the chronological history. the other day.
Recommended.
And I didn't have an easy way to get there. Now I do.
Yeah.
Now you do.
That book eventually.
And as new formats of that particular book come out, it's submitted to iBooks and Nook. It just hasn't showed up yet. I will add them to that website.
Yeah. And as we get the illustrated version done.
One click on Kindle.
We get the illustrated version done next year or whenever we're doing it. And that'll even be more available. So
we can highlight that up there with an illustration.
Whoa. Drawn by me. Fantastic stuff. Well, Tom Merritt, it's always a pleasure. Please do enjoy your day. And I'll see you tomorrow for Tech News Today. How's that sound?
Yeah, that sounds awesome, man. Thanks.
All right. Well, thanks for hanging out.
Cool. Bye,
Remember
Thomas.
To count your silverware before Justin leaves.
I know, dude. I counted it before. I just got to count after.
Hi,
Neil. There he goes. Into the sunset, as he is often likely to do. And that, ladies and gentlemen, ends our broadcast day. I do have one email. Almost.
Yeah, we have a couple things.
Well, a couple things. Let me mention this email here that says, Dear Scott and Brian. Jeez, that's just a regular old email.
Mm-hmm.
Just wanted to say that the eye surgery tool your doctor may have been made in Salt Lake City. I work in the IT department of a company who makes these devices, and I can attest that they are assembled with love by some of the nicest South Koreans and Bosnians you've ever met. By the way, the tool does not grind your eye. It creates mini vortexes, which somehow create massive amounts of heat that melt the offending tissue. Love the show. Mr. Courtney White, Libertarian candidate for Utah, Senate District 19. I think that's actually true. He's really actually right.
Wait, really?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think so.
That's awesome.
But I think I know that. I think I even know the company he works for, which I won't mention. I don't want to get him in trouble. But they're highly regarded as a medical device manufacturing company thing. And so if they're using that stuff to cut into my eye, I guess I feel better about it.
How do you feel about little mini vortexes melting your eye tissue?
That's weird, because I thought it was a sonic thing, like sound, but this changes things, if that's what it is. I guess I feel okay about it. It's a little more Star Trek-y, you know?
Mini vortexes. Yeah, totally.
Mini vortexes. So Stitcher Awards are happening.
Yes.
And you're nominated.
And we're all nominated.
Aren't we? Like, FilmSec's nominated.
Well, FilmSec is what I meant. Yeah, FilmSec. So Brian, Randy, Brian, and Scott. I am one of those Brians. I don't know. I think I was the third one. FilmSec is nominated for a Stitcher Award for movies and TV. And Coverville is nominated for a music podcast. And it's like going up against all of these commercially produced, you know, like public radio, people, staffs that are the size of football teams working on these things. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So come on, help us vote for the little guy. Just go to stitcher.com. You'll see the banner right there on the front page. Stitcher.com. They spell it with an E.
They do.
It's not like, you know, little.
It's not like Flickr. Flickr.
Right. Yeah. Flickr. Yeah.
Number one, let me say this to everybody. If you're listening, you know, like chat realm, please support, obviously all of the Frog Pants programs, but Coverville specifically, especially in the category that you guys are in. Like, you're not kidding. The difference between your podcast and everybody else is that they got a staff of people doing this. This is a complete labor of love by Brian. If you've never listened to Coverville, do yourself a GD favor and go listen to a couple episodes today. It is fantastic. It's one of my it never fails that you know, whenever I turn on Coverville, I always love it. It's such a labor of awesomeness. So
heart happy, JRY.
No, it is. I'll tell you what. It's always one of those things where, like, I always forget to listen to it, like, on a regular basis. Then every once in a while I'll be like, oh man, I should listen to another episode of Coverville, and I'll catch up on like five or six. And it's always a delight.
Yeah. It's a great show. Please vote. Please vote.
And vote for FilmSec.
Won't someone think of Coverville? I'd put your flies on your face and a number to call. Yes.
Just one vote a day can keep Coverville fed
and
for
you know,
the wings of an angel.
And I am telling you, man, FilmSec deserves your love, too. We work hard on that show. We have a blast doing it. If you want to hear things like this,
Outlander! Then
you need to freaking support it so that we can have Malachi yell Outlander every time we
Malachi,
want.
Finish that bran muffin, dude.
Yeah, just finish
and
that
then,
up,
and
buddy.
Then do your line.
Yeah. If you want to hear weird screams like this. Whoops. You want to hear this? Or maybe even, hold on, one last one. Or this one. Then FilmSec is the show to vote for.
Field of Screams.
Field
right
of
there.
Screams. If you build it, they will. Nice timing. All right, so that's that. That's going on. That's a thing to do. What else? What else? Reminder, this weekend, if you are a World of Warcraft fan, Saturday from 10 a.m. Mountain Time until about 3 p.m. that same day, whatever that is, whatever the five-hour block is.
BlizzCon.
We'll be doing BlizzCon 2012.
Oh, cool.
So for the first hour, to be a regular old instance show with me and Terpster and Dills. After that, me and the boys, at least I think one or they're going to be able to hop in and out, but it's me, at least me, anchoring panel discussions with various experts in and around other Blizzard stuff. So we'll have the guys from StarCast to talk about StarCraft 2. Cool. We'll have guys from Raid, who are we having on? Convert to Raid, duh.
Coltrane and Pat Crane. Zug and all those guys.
They're going to come on and talk about raiding, the state of raiding, what's going on, tips and tricks, stuff like that. And it goes on throughout the day, all these different guests. Callers will be calling in, tons of giveaways and prizes. I got a huge stack over there. I just got a giveaway on the show. All Blizzard-related stuff, most of it anyway.
Yeah, look at that. It's a veritable treasure trove.
Yeah, there's a ton over there. And what else? Oh, and we'll do some live video streams as well after the thing ends so people can watch people on their Twitch stream.
Run a heroic with Scott Johnson and Zug.
Yeah. Well, if you're on our server, you could maybe work that out. Although I guess they have the cross server. How's that work now?
I forget. He's part of AIE, so.
Well, no, he is. But I'm wondering if we can have fans just join up if we do like a cross. I don't think they're doing cross.
No, you better create a character on Earthen Ring and start leveling it up to 90 now, so that by Saturday,
get on
you
it.
You can run a heroic. Run Mogashan
Shadow Pan
Monastery or something.
All those Asian names. So join us for that. What else? That's it. Let's get out of here.
Saturday, you said, right?
Oh yeah, Saturday. Saturday the 25th, is it? Yeah. Yeah, that's the plan.
Saturday will be the 27th. This coming Saturday?
Yeah, is it this Saturday? It's 27th?
Sorry, the 20th, I'm sorry.
20th? No, it's
24th. No, it is the 27th.
No, you're right. Tomorrow's the 25th, 6th, 7th. You're right, 27th. Jeez.
I'm looking at November.
Yeah.
Man, this year.
Yeah, don't do that. This year went fast.
Flying
it continues to go fast. And my dog's cleaning her vajayjay. Wonderful.
Hilarious.
So I want to thank VTWProductions.com for today's Shoutcast stream. Thank you, guys. The bandwidth for today's podcast provided by EasyNet. Scott Fletcher does our voice bumpers, and he's amazing. Today's theme by Rob Goobers. And you can find us on the web, frogpants.com/TMS, facebook.com/TheMorningStream. You can email us, and please do, themorningstream@gmail.com. We're on Twitter, MorningStream, Scott Johnson, and Coverville, and Justin R. Young. Oh, one quick note. Wendy will be on tomorrow, Therapy Thursday. Get ready to be helped in some way.
Therapized
with some kind of cool therapy topic. Justin Robert Young, what the hell is going on with your life that you would like to tell the listeners before this thing ends?
Holy poop. Of course, just follow me on Twitter, Justin R. Young. And other than that, I mean, NSFW show, go check out the old FSL tonight with me and Tom Merritt if you enjoyed our banter.
Your seasonal banter.
Seasonal banter. Mm-hmm. And, NSFW show, Weird Things, the podcast. We're off this week because of travel concerns, but we'll be back with a vengeance next week. Sometime today, hopefully, I will have written my Walking Dead recap, which you can read on weirdthings.com.
Mm-hmm.
That's about it.
Yeah. And, thanks for hanging out. It was a blast.
Yeah. Oh, geez. It's so, so much fun to finally actually be in here and sit in on this whole show. So thank you guys for having me.
My humble, dumb basement is now.
It's amazing. This is great. Frogman Studios has lived up to all expectations.
It's pretty weird in here. Do you like my Fonzie scheme on the ceiling?
Oh,
there?
It's great. Yeah. I'm trying to think of which one I want to commission you to so I can hang in my apartment.
I may even have one of those Fonzie ones left. I should give you that. Anyway, it's been a blast having you around, and we'll have to do this again next time you're in Salt Lake. It's going to do it. Brian.
Yes.
No Coverville today, but you put one up last night.
I did. It was cameo appearances. So sometimes bands do covers where they bring in the original artist to do like a guest vocal, like chorus or something like that.
Right.
So you've got a whole bunch of covers that feature cameo appearances by the original artist.
Nice. I think I would enjoy that.
And I did avoid playing the Shatner version of, which song was it? Bohemian Rhapsody that features Brian May on guitar.
Oh.
No, you don't. Nobody needs to hear that.
You don't think so?
Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Wow. All right.
Thunderbolts and Lightning!
Does one of them feature a cameo by the band Cameo?
Oh, no. Like a word up? That would just be too meta.
Yeah. I have a couple Shatners here for you. Want to hear a couple? Just for fun?
Yeah, sure.
There's one. Here's another one.
That's Iron Man lives again.
How about this one?
Nobody helps him.
And then finally,
hey, right?
Whoops, there's the hay.
Hey.
I love the hay.
Hey.
All right. So there's your Shatner moment. That's awesome. Thank you, Brian Ibbott. Song for us. You got something to sing song before we go?
I do. Kev, also known as Crazy in the Tadpool with a K. Says, hi, Fry and Bender. As a daily live listener of TMS, I appreciate your dedication and commitment to the show and to the Tadpool. Thank you. My birthday, he said thank you, but I'll say it too. Thank you. My birthday is October 24th, and I'd like to request a cover of a song from my favorite band of my teen years, Depeche Mode.
Peach Depressed Ice Cream. Mood. It's Peach Ice Cream.
Covered by a new favorite band of mine over the past year or so, Breaking Benjamin. Can you please play Enjoy the Silence as performed by Breaking Benjamin, found on their Shallow Bay Deluxe album. In spite of your perfections, I thoroughly enjoy the shows. Truly, Kev, a.k.a. Crazy.
Nice. Nice. Well, that sounds crazy. Great. Are you a fan of this? You like the Depeche Mode?
I do like the Depressed Mood, yes. I like Breaking Benjamin's cover. I like, I think Depeche Mode is an infinitely coverable band because you can take their songs outside of the kind of mellow, depressing sound that they have and punch them up with all different genres and different styles. It's cool.
Yeah.
They're coverable.
Yes. Well, good. Well, let's play. Should we play it?
Why do I feel like that was a stall so you could get something ready to
I might have. I might have pulled this up.
Wesley, get off the bridge, you little piece of shit.
I might have done that. But I was looking for a good, like, a little some info. You know, like, we did a little advice on the way out. Like, let's pick, I've played these before. How about just this one?
With its short, close fuzz and tender skin.
Just to celebrate Justin being here.
Yeah!
Yeah. That's going to do it for us, everybody. Thank you for joining, especially you, chat room. We love you most of all.
Yes.
We're going to be back tomorrow with a brand new show. Please tune in then. Until then, everybody, suck it. We'll talk to you later.
Through into my little world, painful to me, pierced right through me. Can't you understand? Oh, my little girl, all I ever wanted, all I ever needed is here in my arms. Words are very unnecessary, they can only do. Pleasure's dreaming, so does the pain. Words are meaningless, unforgettable. All I ever wanted, all I ever needed is here in my arms. Words are very unnecessary, they can only do of every unnecessary, they can only do harm. All I ever wanted.
Where did I park my car? Oh, no.
Where is it? All right. So that was fun.
That was fun. Yeah. I see that he just ran out as soon as the show was over.
He's worried. He's messing me up because I have to leave in about 35 minutes.
Oh, for a meeting or something?
So I think he's worried that he's going to mess me up, and I'm like, dude, you're fine. And he's like, oh, I'll just go take a shower. I'll be fast. I said, all right. So he is in no risk of screwing me up. He just thinks he is. But he's a very gracious guest.
He's
you know, all those things.
Aww.
And Kim just, you know, pulls out all the stops every time anyone's
there. She does. I notice, yeah. Brings breakfast
brings
down.
Food, makes
stuff. She's fantastic.
Stuff. She is great. I don't deserve her at all.
Jeez, no.
Daisy, how clean does your vagina have to be? I mean, she is in scrub mode over there. What's going on?
I have to be able to eat off of it.
Something
like that.
That was fun. I had a ball.
I did too. That was great.
But it's probably a little crazy. Just when you add the new dynamic of an extra person live like that, it's kind of, you know, changes it up. But I feel like we did all right.
I think so, and it helps that he's not brand new to this. You know that we've done this Tuesdays for a while, or Thursdays even for a while before that. So we have our rhythms figured out, and I think it worked out very well.
Yeah, we're all in the same family,
and we all learned something. I learned about a Wang and Teen Wolf.
We all stuffed the same whopper in the same toilet hole.
That's right.
Everything's fine. Meh. I won't be raiding tonight though, because we got App Slappy. Big App Slappy as a result because of this.
Got to talk about the Mac, the Mini, the iPad Mini.
Mini.
Or yeah,
so I'm thinking, I'm leaning towards, after Tom's thing, I'm thinking I might go look for a cheap Nexus 7.
You know what? They're pretty cool. I have this one I've been playing with. It's all right.
Yeah.
I still think now, given the choice, if I was looking for a little one, I still think I'd get the iPad Mini, though.
Really?
Here's a question
for the Nexus 7. I know it can handle flash. How does it handle
Facebook? No longer flash.
The Nexus 7 doesn't?
Android has, there is no, remember how that was a big hot point thing for a while? Apple won't run flash, but
Apple
we will.
Apple can't do flash.
No,
yeah.
Android has no longer has official support for flash, period.
Oh, really?
You're more likely to get an app in the iOS store that will support flash than you will having Android support flash right now.
Huh.
Which is too funny. Like, the flashback couple years, that was like the big divider line. Now no one gives two shits, because they knew it too. Flash is bloated and a pain.
That's crazy. Yeah, well, and it's a security risk.
So I have the Nexus 7 right here, and it won't run Flash.
That's crazy. Okay, so, well, forget that then.
Yeah. So I don't know that would be
enough. Maybe a Galaxy Tab. Should I get a Galaxy Tab?
Galaxy Tab? Oh, my gosh. They've only got half a calorie for every tab. wrong tab. Yes, I think that 7 is actually pretty cool. It's all right.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if they're really going to do this $99 deal, someone in the chat room just mentioned that. There's talk that they're going to do that. If they do that, that becomes really, really attractive then.
Oh yeah, I'll wait, and if it happens, I'm absolutely buying a $99 Nexus 7.
Yeah, it makes seven. It makes sense. Shake things up. Add to your proliferation of gadgetry, and besides, that one will upgrade to other versions of the OS and like all the other stupid brands. So get that one. All right. Well, I'm not, so I won't see you tonight, but I will see you tomorrow.
Cool.
And Groovy. Thanks for all you do.
Oh, dude, thank you, too.
And don't put your penis in electrical sockets.
Actually, looks like tonight we're doing heroic. So after you finish App Slappy, depending on what it is, hop in. At least it won't be sitting there beating up, trying to beat up the same Firelands heroic boss.
It depends on how long-winded Eric gets. You know, he can get.
Oh, God, I know.
Blah, 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 blah. Hopefully he's listening. All right.
Aww.
Thanks, man. I'll talk to you soon. And here's my advice to you. Here's some good advice. Don't urinate on a muscular hobo. There.
Oh, okay.
That's the one. Bye. Okay, that's it. Thank you, guys. I'm going to hang up on you right after I do this. Is it weird having this camera the way we've set it up? It's kind of weird. What's going on here? Here we go. That's how I put passwords in. Play. Play. Archives. Run. Exit. Exit. All right. You guys are awesome. I'll talk to you soon. Thank you so much. Bye now.